Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for the Tech Guy is provided by CacheFly. CacheFly.com. Hi, this is Leo Laporte, and this is my Tech Guy podcast. This show originally aired on the Premier Radio Networks on Sunday, September 15th, 2013. This is episode 1014. Enjoy. The Tech Guy podcast is brought to you by RingCentral. I love my cloud-based phone system from RingCentral. Zero startup costs, and RingCentral is $20 per month per user. Try it now with a 30-day risk-free trial. And when you buy one desk phone, you'll get a second phone free. Up to 20 phones. Call 800-543-9980 or visit ringcentral.com and use the promo code TWIT. Well, hey, how are you today? Leo Laporte here, the Tech Guy. Yes, it's time to talk about computers and the internet, cell phones, and what else? That's pretty much it. Oh, okay. Home theater if you want, digital photography for sure. GPS? Yeah, I guess. Whatever's on your mind. If it's got a chip in it, we want to talk about it. 8888-ASK-LEO, that's my number. That's toll-free from anywhere in the U.S. and Canada. Outside the U.S. and Canada, you can still use Skype or something similar to call, and it won't cost you a thing. Love to hear from you. The phone ranger, Heather Hammond, will be taking your calls, speaking with you, preparing you for the excitement of appearing on live radio. It's back, baby. I read an article the other day how AM radio is dead. Boy, that's a shock to me. The people who love it know it. Want it, and it's still got a huge audience. When I compare, for instance, I do a dozen internet shows. I guess you could call them podcasts, although they're live at twit.tv. You can download them as on-demand audio and video. I don't know. Podcast seems so small compared to what it is, but I do about a dozen of them. None of them has the reach of the radio show. Of course, the radio show's on almost 200 stations, but this show reaches probably a million people every weekend, something close to that. So you can go on and on about how old radio is dying and all the internet killed the radio star, but it's not true. It's not true, and especially in people's cars as they're driving around. We're on satellite too. I think satellite qualifies as that. It's such a wonderful medium. It's such a powerful medium. It's a way of bringing people together. And here's the key to it. It's live. That's what I think that's what really, the more I think about it, the more I like live. Both doing it, because it's real. It's not take three, take 100, take 400. It's take one every time. But also because it's live, I can interact with callers live. You couldn't do that if it weren't live. I can interact with it. We have a chat room going all the time. It wouldn't be there if this were a recording. Who's to talk to, right? Even, I think TV even knows this, because those morning shows, when you get up first thing and you turn on the TV while you're making breakfast, getting the kids ready for school, those are live. The Today Show, Good Morning America, CBS Morning, This Morning, or whatever they call it. Those are live, and there's a reason they're live. Because you want live people at that hour of the day. You want to see somebody actually there who's keeping you company. I think that's something radio does so well, as more and more television, even the nightly news and certainly the talk shows, late-night talk shows, are recorded. There's something special about knowing that when, as I'm saying this, I'm here, sitting here, you're sitting there, driving your car or whatever you're doing, mowing the lawn. And it's almost as if we're having a conversation. It's a real person talking to a real person. I don't think the internet can kill that. And the internet's not well suited to live, frankly. Look at the Apple TV. There's a good example. Apple has a pretty popular device. I think it's sold more than any other set-top box, like the Roku or any Boxy box or any of the others. It sold, what was the last count? Something like 13 million. Very little live stuff on there, and they're very slowly squeezing the live stuff onto there. The summertime is when Apple TV actually does live. They do an iTunes festival. But it's in London, so it's the middle of the day for here us in the U.S., so it's not the ideal time. But even with Apple TV, you know, the internet's just not well suited to live. They can't just go crazy with live. I love it. I love it. I love the back and forth and so forth. Oh, shoot. I left my iPhone in the car. I was going to talk about the iPhone. No. Thank you, Heather. Yours is a little too old for me.
Yeah, sorry.
It's an
iPhone
4.
Everything about me is old. Wait.
Not as old as me. But I do have in the car an iPhone 5 running the new iOS 7, and I wanted to talk a little bit. I guess since it's radio, I could just... Here I have in my hand, as you can see, the iPhone 5.
It's glistening.
Yes.
Wow, it's fabulous,
shiny,
Leo.
Gold. Look at that.
I'm so jelly.
I had the choice, of course, between... it was black. They now call it space gray.
Graphite?
Space gray. I don't know what that means.
Please.
And then but then the funny thing, and then there's white, which is just white. And then not eggshell, not ecru, not beige, just white. And then I thought for sure that the gold phone, they'd call it champagne. Champagne wishes and caviar dreams. But no, they call it gold. Isn't that funny? What is that you have there?
I have a bottle of champagne right here.
Well, there it is. I thought it was Goldwasser. So, a couple of new things in it. We got a new camera, a little bit of an improvement. Not a big improvement, but a little bit of an improvement on the camera. It's faster. That means it does better in lower light. In fact, they've increased the size of the dots on the pickup, which really does make a difference. So that's good. And they've got this dual flash. It's two colors. It's on the blue side and on the yellow side, the cold side and the warm side. And that's so it can match the flash color to the color of the room or the space. So if you're outside, it'll be more blue because outdoors is blue. If it's inside, it'll be warmer. It'll be more yellow. And they can mix anywhere on a scale of 0 to 1,000. They can mix those two lights to match. I think I've never seen anybody do that. That'll be interesting. They added a fingerprint reader, not the first on a smartphone. Motorola did it with the Atrix, but it was terrible. It didn't work. I think Apple's will work better. Last year, they bought, for some billion dollars, I can't remember what it was, the Authentic company, which made the most popular fingerprint reader. You've probably seen it in Lenovo laptops. A lot of laptops use Authentic fingerprint readers. Apple bought them. That was the first signal that they were looking at doing something like this. So when they got them, I think it was a sign. Hey, here comes a fingerprint reader in some form or fashion. They got the patents, of course, which means they kind of own this. And now it's built into the new iPhone 5S. Not the C. There's two. The C is the colorful kitty phone. That's basically just an iPhone 5 in a colorful plastic wrapper. Which I should just point out. Everybody I've seen, and of course the younger they are, the more colorful they are, everybody I know has a case for their iPhone. Even Jesse Pinkman has a Hello Kitty case on his phone. Which is kind of funny.
That's awesome.
Who has a phone? Doesn't everybody, you got a case on your phone, I got a case. Everybody puts a case on. And if you're of a mind to have a colorful phone, then you have a colorful case. You don't have a case on your phone, sir. Have you ever dropped it?
Not yet.
That's why you don't have a case on it. Wait till you drop it. You'll have a case on it in a hurry, in a heartbeat. Because it's made of glass. Anyway, I guess for people who just didn't understand that they could put a case on their phone and make it colorful, Apple now has colorful 5Cs, which are just like the 5. $100 less, not a lot less, a little bit less. It's the kind of less expensive phone, I think, for younger people, under 25 set, you know. And then if it weren't colorful enough, they're making their own cases. I think Apple realized, you know, we're kind of missing a little bit of money by letting everybody and their brother make a mint on iPhone cases, and we don't make any. So they made a case for this iPhone 5C, and the ironic part is it's the same colors with holes in it. It looks like a Swiss cheese or a crock. Actually, it's what it looks like, a crock. The 5C stands for 5 crock. And you put the crock on top of your phone, and the idea is they think that the kiddles will pick contrasting colors in an effort to further annoy their parents. Joey, don't you know purple and green clash? Sally, you can't have two reds and a pink. It just doesn't work. No, I don't know why they did it. But I know why they did it, because it's worth some money. It's just a piece of plastic, and they can sell it for $30. But the 5S, that's the flagship. That's the one in black, white, and gold. Fingerprint reader is very interesting. It's on where the home button would be. Oh, am I out of time? Wow, and I haven't even gotten through all the rest of the features. Oh, no, that's it. iOS 7, too. Leo Laporte, the tech guy, will take your phone calls. I'll answer your questions about that in just a bit. Call quality on the Moto X. Jeff, I have no idea because I never make calls. I haven't noticed anything. Nobody's complained. I think it's fine. It has 3 microphones. That's got to be better than 2. There's something about the Moto X I just really like. I think it's the size and the shape and the feel. It just feels good in the hand. I love that skip thing I was demonstrating, the idea that I can use a strong, long, unwieldy password, but when I'm at home or in the car or I've put it on my little skip thing, it's unlocked. I don't have to enter it. Less secure, of course, because if a bad guy can get gets a hold of my little skipper, my little skip to my loo, he can get my stuff. Oh, you know, think about it now. When you say HTC and Samsung just copy Apple, think about that for just a moment before you rush to judgment. I gotta run. I'll go at the top of the hour. I'll go get my iPhone 5. What did Apple add to the iOS 7? Oh, yeah, that slide-up thing with all the, turn off the Wi-Fi airport mode. Yeah, ever see that before anywhere? Where had I seen that before? Oh, yeah, Samsung and HTC. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. They all copy each other. It's ridiculous to say Apple is being copied any more than anybody else is being copied. You can use your own headphones with a mic, of course. HTC One is quite nice. I think it's a nice phone. But more and more, I'm becoming a fan of pure Google. Why am I always bashing Apple? Is it hurting your feelings? 7087. Is it hurting your feelings? Is it hurting your feelings?
Did you just now call?
Leo Laporte, the tech guy, 8888. Ask Leo. That's the phone number. You got a question, a comment, a suggestion. We also have a great website, techguylabs.com. Now, if you go there, you'll see a whole bunch of stuff. You can get in the chat room. We have a wonderful chat room. Family friendly. Get in there. You could talk to me and talk to the other people, about 700 or 800 people in there. We also have on the website answers to your questions, previous shows, audio and video, and the phone number, so you can get that. All at techguylabs.com. So if you hear something, you know, on the show, and you're driving, you can't write it, don't worry about it. We got somebody writing it down for you. We've got our the show secretary, James Dreveau, is writing everything down. He's taking the minutes. So, Heva, phone ranger.
Jeez.
Jeez. Who should I talk to?
Well, I really want to go to Sam in San Diego.
San Diego, California. Hi, Sam.
Diego.
San Diego in the house.
Hey, good hearing you. Back again, Leo. Hey, look, I'm really envious of you, man. I know you're leaving pretty soon, and hope you have a safe trip. And, my God, I can't wait for you to get back and tell us all about it.
I will have a great time. Now, here's the good news. While I am out of the country, I'm going on an Adriatic cruise. We have all new shows we've recorded ahead of time without your knowledge. We've secretly, in our secret lair, recorded all new shows. So there is, you will hear no reruns. You will hear no guest host. You will hear me as if I am here. You will even be able to see the video as if I am here, but I'm not. But I'll be back. I'll be back, and there'll be new shows in October. So it's just a little vacation every once in a while. We all have to. Yeah, I'm exhausted.
Well, look, yesterday, getting down to the call here, Leo, yesterday you were talking earlier about these tone ringers for your cell phones.
Yeah.
Well, look, I went online.
Wait a minute, Jim.
I want to get a decent one. A decent free one.
Yeah, well, first of all, yeah, that's okay. Ringtones are the biggest ripoff ever.
I could bet that, but I understand this. Someone told me there's 4 to choose from, which is Ventones, Cool Free.
No. Don't go to any website and get ringtones. What kind of phone do you have?
I got just a simple AT&T Pantech.
Okay. Is it an Android phone or is it a feature phone? Is it just a plain old phone?
It's a plain old phone.
No,
it's, yeah.
So the issue, the phone companies get you on these. What do they charge? Like $1.99? It's not even forever. It's like for 3 months or something, 6 months. It's a huge business. In fact, the ringtone business is bigger than the music industry. And the funny thing is, you may already own the song. And you say, I really like that Avril Lavigne. I want her on my ringtone. And you say, but I already have the song. How do I make it a ringtone? A ringtone is just an audio file on your phone. And you shouldn't have to pay for ringtones. It's ridiculous. The music industry loves the revenue, but you really shouldn't have to buy it. And it's really ridiculous that you don't even own it. You rent it. That's ridiculous. But, of course, the cell phone companies are in cahoots with this, so they don't really give you an easy way to do this. It is a $2 billion, I guess it's smaller than the overall music industry, but it's big. In 2011, it was a $2 billion a year business. It was pretty close to the size of iTunes. In 2011, the subscription services like RDO and Spotify were worth about $500 million. The download services like iTunes were worth $3.5 billion. And ringtones were worth $2.1 billion. A third of all the music revenue worldwide was ringtones. And it's not genuine revenue because if you own the song, buy the song for 99 cents and make a ringtone. Now, it's easy, very easy to do this on a smartphone. If you have an Android phone, I think it's called Droid. What's it called? Droid Ringer or something. Many Android phones don't even need to do anything special. And some even come, the music players on most Android devices come with a little editor that you can just say, I want this little snippet. The key on a ringtone is just an MP3 or other playable music file. Usually it's an MP3 stored in a special directory. And then when you start to choose your ringtones, the picker goes and looks and says, here's his ringtones. What did I use? Because the Moto X that I use does not have, it uses the Google Music Player, which doesn't unfortunately have a ringtone editor. So I had to download a ringtone editor, and I don't remember what the name of it was. Something like Droid Tone or something. You shouldn't pay for this. Ring Droid. Thank you, Uncle Bick. That's the name of it. Ring Droid. And Ring Droid's great, because Ring Droid just says, okay, here's all the music you have on your phone. Which one do you want to make a ringtone out of? I'll say, I'm going to use Vivaldi's Largo. And then it shows you a waveform. It lets you pick which part of the thing you want, how long it's going to be. You can even sample it ahead of time. And if you like it, you clip it and you save it. And it's smart enough to save it to where you want it to be. So this is where smartphones have an advantage. Because there's on iPhone, I think Apple actually builds it into iTunes, don't they? They used to. So making a ringtone simple. The problem is these older feature phones, like your Pantech, Sam, may not have a built-in way to do it. And because it doesn't have apps, you can't just install something like Ring Droid. So what song do you want?
Well, nothing really in particular, to tell you the truth. I'd just like to choose a few.
You only have four on that Pantech? That's terrible.
Well, you know, my wife has a smartphone, and so maybe
she's figured out how to do this. So there are variety. It's the key is you can make the audio. The key on the desktop, even you can use a audio editor like Audacity, which is free. Make it, save it out as an MP3. The key is to get it onto the phone in the right spot, and these feature phones, unfortunately. Don't really give you a way to do that. There's third-party software out there. I really don't like the idea of going to a website, freeringtones.com, that kind of thing. That's a bad idea. First of all, a lot of times they want money after a while. We'll put some links in the show notes. Web 2221 is showing how to do a ringtone for iPhones on Windows. It's built in. Unless they took it out, it was built into the iPhone. And many of the customizations that Samsung, HTC, LG, and others have done have that feature built into the music player. If you want to see, if you have an Android phone, press and hold a song in your phone's music player, and see if you can, if there's a set as ringtone menu item. There usually is. That's nice because then you can have a bunch of music on your phone and you can have a different song for everybody who calls. Because you can set as ringtone for the whole phone and then you should have one default ringtone. Mine's James Bond, as I mentioned yesterday. But you can also have individual ringtones for different members of the family, different people who call you. The boss would be the one you really want a crazy one for. What would you have for the boss calling, Heather? Something mean. I don't know what you'd have. Oops, I potted you down. Hold on. Hey, we got to take it. What did you say? I'm sorry.
I'll have to think of one
for
you.
Let's think of a mean. I'm not your boss. I'm not the boss of you. Thanks, Sam. Leo Laporte, the tech guy, 8888 Ask Leo. Call my boss. Shut up of your mouth. What's the matter, you? Yeah, BitPim is the program that I used to use, and it's very flaky and funky. But BitPim, I was trying to remember the name, was what I used to use in my old feature phones. It's a free program, and it's funky as heck, as all get out. But it does at least let you access the data on the phone without hacking, without rooting or anything like that. And it is free. Windows, Mac, and Linux. BitPim. And that's what I used to use in the old days. But, man, the thing would crash every 5 seconds. You look at it funny, it'd crash. Yeah, ringtones kind of frost me because it feels to me like a little bit of a greedy play by the music industry. Like, well, we got Billy Idol his money for his album and we got it for the single. And actually, well, they didn't even want to do singles for a while because they wanted to sell you the album. And so, you know, he had a hit on the album. You'd buy all 12 cuts, even though one of them. Eventually, they realized, well, we got to do singles. They did 45s. Remember those? You're probably too young to remember those. There's a great scene. There was a movie HBO about Phil Spector, about his murder trial and the whole thing. It was a wonderful movie. Al Pacino plays Phil Spector. I didn't even know it existed. I just found it on demand one night. Helen Mirren's in it. She plays Phil Spector's attorney, and they're talking about music, the music biz, and how Phil Spector transformed the music biz. And the young guy says, "I don't know what you're talking about. Who is he?" And she holds up a little yellow piece of plastic. Looks like kind of like an S-curve. It's a little strange, a little circular yellow. She says, "Do you know what this is?" He says, "Well, I have no idea." So then she takes a 45 record. She says, "Do you know what this is?" He said, "I think you used to put music on that, right?" "Yes." "So yeah, you put this little yellow piece of plastic, in the hole of this, and you can play it on a turntable and go away from me because you don't know about music." So what was I talking about? Singles. So the record industry really fought Apple's decision to sell 99-cent singles. They said, "We don't want to do this. People won't buy albums." The artists got up in arms. "Well, you know, we've created this album. It's a story as a whole. We don't want you just to buy one cut from that. We want you to buy the album. It's a work of art." And it happens to be $20. As opposed to 99 cents, or $10 as opposed to 99 cents. Nevertheless, Apple, well, I think what happened is Apple snuck in under the radar. The record industry thought, nobody's going to, this iPod is never going anywhere. And this iTunes thing, what the heck? Let's try it. That kid Jobs, he seems like a nice kid. I'll give him a shot. And then, of course, iTunes quickly becomes the number one way people buy music. And most of it is 99 cent singles. And they're going, oh. So along come ringtones. Hey, this Jobs guy really got us, but wait a minute. Ringtones. We'll get them back. Instead of a 99-cent single, we'll charge them $1.99 for 3 months of a 20-second clip. And on the older non-smartphones, you could do that. And everybody was happy. The phone company was happy because you bought it from AT&T or Verizon or whoever your phone company was. They got their cut. Record industry got their cut. Billions of dollars. But it made no sense because if you already owned the song, you could just take just snip it up and put it in the ringtone folder, and there it is. Fortunately, we've come a long way. We've come a long way. You know, what happens is that guy with the cigar, he retires. What do you mean retire? I'm only 83. He retires. Goodbye. Young guy comes in and says, "Yeah, I like buying music on iTunes. And you know what? I just noticed something. We're making a lot of money. we're making some money here. If you just know how to do it, you use the social media, you use the MTV, whatever it is, and you know, that Miley Cyrus, she's raking it in. 99 cent singles are good. And then the whole world changed a little bit. I still think they're a little bitter about the ringtones, though. 8888 Ask Leo. Jim in Claremont, California. You're next. Hi, Jim. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Hi, Leo. Hi. I was hoping you could put me in the right direction. I purchased a new computer for myself at home that has Windows 8. I tried to install Dragon Home Version 12, and I can't get it to work. And I've had a computer technician come in. He couldn't get it to work.
And you're asking me? Well, does Dragon, Night Dragon's from a company called Nuance. Does Nuance say that Dragon works on Windows 8? It should.
They claim it does. I called Nuance. Took me an hour, and they finally said maybe your disk isn't being read correctly. But
that's it's something like that. Because if in fact Dragon, naturally speaking, didn't install on Windows 8, you would be hearing howls, right? But
right.
We're not. So it's you.
Okay. Okay.
It's not me. It's you.
Okay.
So what we got to figure out is what's going on with your system, and that's the first thing to suspect. People assume, hey, it's a CD, or a DVD. It's perfect. No, they can often be messed up. So did you trade it in?
No, I
trade it in. It's probably just a bad disc.
Okay, I'll go back.
It happens all the time.
Okay, I'll go back and try it again.
People look at that shiny, beautiful disc and they say, well, it's perfect. What could possibly go wrong? Well, in fact, it can easily be a mess. One way to do this, somebody in the chat room saying this is true. Toilet Bug, I hate saying your name, Toilet Bug. Would you get a better handle? Says, if you copy the contents of the DVD of the installer to the hard drive and then try, that might work. And the reason for that is, in the copy process, a flaky bit of the DVD might be read.
Okay.
And you know, it might take a little longer to copy that DVD because it works a little harder. But once it's read and it's on the hard drive, it might install just fine from there.
Well, I had the computer technician, maybe I misspoke. He came in, he was from the Make It Work.
Oh, people. They're good. Okay.
Yeah, he came in and he tried that. He tried to install.
Yeah.
But when he runs the program, everything grinds to a halt. And he says it uses 100% of the hard drive. So he went back and double-checked the hard drive, the memory, the
processor. Wait. He said it fills up the hard drive? Well, that's not good.
Well, the hard drive, he says that everything grinds to a halt. And when he checks the hard drive, it says using 100%.
No, he's checking the memory, system memory, and that's completely normal.
Ah, okay.
That's not bad. It's the way computers are designed today, you've got a certain amount of RAM, 4 gigs of RAM probably.
Right.
And program doesn't need all of that, but Dragon, naturally speaking, the more of its vocabulary it can load into memory, the better. Faster it'll be. So what it does is it says, how much RAM? Oh, I'll take it all, thank you. And if somebody needs it, it gracefully bows out. But that's what it's supposed to do. So I don't think that's the problem. Maybe it was 100% of the CPU, even that. Modern computers are designed to use your resources. Why waste it? Oh, I'll only use 50%. Maybe he still needs 50%. I don't want to, use it all, right?
Mm.
So I don't know if that means anything.
Okay.
It could, but I don't think it does. It sounds like even if it installed properly with no errors.
Yeah, he said it installed, but when you go to run the program to open it, it just, everything stops. You can't get it to, you know. You can't get it to work. You can't get it to even go to the next step, which is your voice recording and train it. You can't get it to
yeah,
run.
Well, it's hard for me to diagnose it from here.
Mm.
If the Make It Work guy couldn't do it, I would get another disk.
Okay.
If it's corrupt, even if it copied over, it might install fine, but then the data files are corrupt, and it wouldn't see that until it actually ran.
Okay.
Is Windows 8 running normally for you in every other respect?
Yes, everything else is perfect.
Yeah, I think it's probably bad. I think it's just something that disk. Try another disk.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. I wish I could give you more help, but it's just impossible for me. I haven't yet figured out how to reach out through the radio, I'm sorry to say. But we look at CDs and DVDs and we say, well, how could anything be wrong? It's flawless. It's like a mirror. Well, it could be. The data recorded on it could be damaged. Russell Phoenix, Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hi, Russell.
Hey. Got a question for you. I'm planning on joining the Apple ecosystem. And currently, I've got a cable modem and a Wi-Fi router in one box. And what I want to do is I want to know if I can take an airport time capsule and use it as a Wi-Fi extender.
Yes. Because the time capsule is a Wi-Fi access point, right? Is it?
Okay.
Is it? Let me think. Yes. Well, wait a minute. No. Is it a... Okay, I have to read up on what the time capsule is. I have avoided that particular product because I don't use Time Machine. Yeah, it is a standard airport router with a built-in hard drive. So you could, and I'll tell you how to do that when we come back. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. 8888. Ask Leo. 888-827-5536. So you've got a time capsule or any... did you get the new one that looks like the little monolith from 2001 A Space Odyssey? Oh, I got to push his button. Wait a minute. Did he go? He went. He disappeared. Did I see somebody on line one? That's not the guy I was talking to. Or was, is it? Russell?
Yeah.
Was Russell that who I was talking to? Oh, I'm sorry, Russell. So did you get the tower one? The new one?
I actually haven't bought it yet.
Oh, okay. So what it is I have the tower one, the new one, and if you open it up, there's a space for a hard drive. If you get the time capsule one, it has a hard drive in it, and that allows you to use it for backup over the network. It's kind of like a simple NAS, network attached storage. So if you've got Apple routers, as you said, you're in the Apple ecosystem, it's a very simple thing. What you're going to be doing is using something called WDS, or the Wireless Distribution System. And what Apple calls it is, when you first set up the router, would you like to set up this router to extend an existing Wi-Fi network? And you say yes. Or you can make it the home base and set up the other router that way. So the one router is connected to your cable modem or DSL modem. The other one's out in space somewhere. It has to be within Wi-Fi range, obviously. And when you configure that second one that's out in space, you say, I want you to extend the existing Wi-Fi network. It'll connect to the network. It'll even appear with the same name. You won't know which one you're on. And then you're both, basically what you've done is extended the range of your Wi-Fi network. Does that make sense?
Yeah, because I was getting two.
Right. You don't want two access points. You have to go back in the settings. And say, now, it's got different names for different companies' routers. So this is, extend your wireless network is an Apple term. Other routers might say WDS or repeater. What you want is the second router, the unconnected router, to be in bridge mode. You don't want it to be doing anything about configuring the network. The main router does that. Your second router is merely a repeater. Does that make sense?
Yeah. I was getting two different answers from Apple. Some said, yes, I can do it. Others say, no, you have to actually connect your time capsule with into the WAN port.
I don't believe that's the case. I think Apple's, the second guide is wrong. It may be faster that way because you're not using Wi-Fi to copy files, but it should still work. I do it. I do it as a time capsule because I don't use Time Machine, but I have when I got the new Apple router, the AC version, plugged that one into the cable modem, took the old Apple router, you could do this with an Airport Express too, took the old Airport Extreme, brought it upstairs, had reconfigured it to extend the network, and now I have upstairs and downstairs routers.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know why they said you couldn't do it. I think they're wrong. The key, though, is to be all Apple.
Okay.
Don't do this with a Linksys.
Okay.
Is that the issue? The other router's not an Apple router?
Yeah, the router that I have is from the cable company, and I
have... I hate it when they do that. So you can disable the cable company's router. And just use the cable company's modem and say, I'm using my own router. So you put the cable company's router in bridge mode. And then you will have to hardwire. That's the difference, and that's why they said this. Then you will have to hardwire the time capsule into the cable modem. Do you have an issue that you cannot, the Wi-Fi doesn't extend throughout the house?
I'm extending to two different buildings on the same property.
Oh, boy, that's tough. How far apart are they?
About 200 feet.
You're not going to be able to do it. It's too far. Not reliably. Wi-Fi goes about 150 feet reliably.
Well, currently, I do have an existing Wi-Fi extender from Belkin that I'm using quite reliably.
Oh, good.
What I want to do is I want to just replace that Belkin extender, with the time capsule.
The problem is this wireless distribution system, while it is a standard, is not a very strict standard, and so different companies implement it differently. And my experience has been that different manufacturers, different chipsets particularly, have trouble doing this together, working together, friendly. So James is telling me in the chat room that the cable modem when in bridge mode is called residential gateway mode. Why they make up new terms for this stuff, I just don't understand. I mean, there's a standard term, but they have to have their own. I'm impressed that you are able to get that to go 200 feet. It must be pointing that router out the window at another router in the window or something like that, because that's a long way to go for Wi-Fi.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm doing.
Yeah, so you're getting almost a directional beam. If you're going to use Apple, go all Apple. You said the word ecosystem. Apple's carefully designed it so that everything works best as long as you don't deviate from the way. And you have deviated, my friend, from the way. I find your lack of faith disturbing. Yeah, I think what you really need to do is go all Apple. So put your cable modem in residential gateway mode. Plug the time capsule into that. Let the time capsule do what we call DHCP. That's the dynamic host configuration protocol. That's the one that assigns the addresses. You might be able to use that Belkin, actually, at that point, as the repeater. You might be able to. And if it doesn't work, then you're going to have to go out and get an Airport Express and do it that way. That's at least it's only $99, right? That's the other thing about Apple. Their stuff is literally two or three times more expensive than the least expensive versions. I buy Apple products, the Apple routers, because I have no trouble with them. And there's a lot to be said. Even if you're paying $200, I'm going to use that for 5 years. And not having trouble, you know, for 5 years is worth $200 to me. I'll pay $20 a year not to have trouble. Actually, how much am I paying? Yeah, something like that. Somebody in the chat room's giving me a link, probably useful. There are a lot of places you can go, practicallynetworked.com, smallnetbuilder.com. We'll put this, thank you, Web9393, in the chat room. We'll put this link in the show notes. It shows you how to do WDS with a variety of different routers and how well they work and the speed. This is a nice little chart. Nice little chart. Thank you. Appreciate that. 8888 asked Leo. John's in Fullerton, California, our next caller. Hi, John. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Hi, Leo. Thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
So I had a question. I've been with Verizon, well, my family has, for about 15, 20 years now.
Wow.
And, yeah, a long time. And they've recently started this, program where if you want to upgrade your phone, you have to re-sign your data plan.
Yeah, isn't that terrible? Unless you pay full freight, $650 for the phone, then you can keep your data plan.
Yeah, and the problem with that is my brother is a cross-country trucker, and we need the data plan because most of the time, that's the only time he gets internet. And unfortunately, my phone died on me.
So you understand what's going on is they basically don't want you to have unlimited internet. So they're making it really hard and expensive for you to keep it. Verizon's policy, as I understand it, is if you buy the phone at the full cost, hey, we'll be glad to keep your internet. Good luck. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hey, the show today brought to you, the podcast, I should say, brought to you by our podcast sponsor and our fine phone system, RingCentral.com. We love our cloud-based phone system from RingCentral. It's affordable. No startup cost, no PBX in the basement. That makes the technology simple. And it starts as low as $19.99 a month per user. And that includes long distance. It includes fax in your email, voicemails in your email, the free RingCentral iPhone and Android app. It is just great. Our producers love getting their voicemail and the email and the faxes on the smartphones. They also have something new called call functioning. This is cool. Of course, you've always been able to have RingCentral ring any number for you, your desktop phone or your iPhone or Android phone. But now they've got something called call functioning. You actually say which order the devices will ring when someone calls your number. Like you can have it ring your desk phone first, then your smartphone. You'll never miss a business opportunity again. You can even choose the number of rings before the call goes to the next device. It's called call functioning. This is why I like a cloud-based phone system like this. They can add features all the time. Nobody has to come go down to the basement, twiddle with a PBX. New people, they plug in their phone. Boom, they're on. We can modify the phone tree. They've got directory lookup. I love the text messages, business text messages from our 800 number to our 800 number goes to the relevant person. Conference calling. They've got Salesforce integrate. I could just go on and on, but the best thing to do would be to go to ringcentral.com right now, tour around, look at the features, and then if you want to try it, we've got a 30-day risk-free trial for you, as always. In fact, we got a really good one for you. So you get 30 days free of RingCentral, but you'll also get our phone deal. When you buy a desk phone, you'll get a second phone free, up to 20 phones. So call 800-543-9980, 800-543-9980, or visit ringcentral.com and use the promo code TWIT. 800-543-9980, ringcentral.com. Leo Laporte, the tech guy, 8888 Ask Leo. That's the phone number if you want to talk about tech. 8888 Ask Leo. If you have a question, a comment, a suggestion, love talking about it. So poor John in Fullerton, he's on Verizon. He has learned of the rule that Verizon has that if you want to re-up, if you want to get a new phone and you want to keep your unlimited data plan, you better pay the full freight on the phone. What's your recourse? Get another phone company. And this is why competition is so important, why it's great that the courts didn't let AT&T buy, who were they trying to buy, T-Mobile? Or was it Sprint? I don't remember. It's great to have choices, and we have four big companies and a lot of little companies, and we want to keep it that way. You don't like Verizon? Hey, guess what? T-Mobile has unlimited data plans, and they'll let you keep it even. Sprint has unlimited data plans. AT&T, on the other hand, CEO of AT&T very famously a few months ago said, biggest mistake I ever made was offering unlimited data plans. So go with the also-ran. It's tough when you're a trucker, of course. Verizon, I think one of the reasons truckers like Verizon, it seems to have the best coverage maps. PC Magazine, Sasha Segan at PC Magazine, who every year does a test of bandwidths, of speed of the major carriers. And this is a challenging thing to do, and I honor him. I gave you his name because I really honor him for doing it. It's a lot of work. Pretty much consistently determines that AT&T nationwide has the best speed, the best download speeds. But I would say Verizon has the most consistent coverage. And in some ways, that's more important. Certainly, if you're a trucker, that's more important. 8888 Ask Leo. Moving on to Tim in Ventura, California. Tim, Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Yeah, hi, Leo. I've got a question I need for business purposes to take photographs off the ground about 20 feet in the air. And so I would like to be able to tether a camera to my Windows 7 operating laptop.
Are you going to float it with a balloon?
Well, I do have a tripod apparatus, but if you have some sort of remote control balloon apparatus you can recommend, I would certainly be interested.
So does it have to be mobile, or is it just going to be one spot fixed?
It will be mobile, but what I'll do is I'll be inside a building.
Yeah.
And I do this multiple places all over the Southwest.
Wait a minute, 20 feet outside?
20 feet in the air. Yeah, inside of a building.
In the lobby? Where do you get 20 feet clearance in a building? In a lobby?
Typically in warehouses.
I see.
I need to do structural inspections.
Oh, how interesting. So you really do need to be able to take that camera closer to a beam or something like that.
Yes, I do. And I need what I'm interested in is not art, obviously, but detail.
Detail stability, then. Because
Yes. Naturally,
the last thing you want is a jiggly platform because you won't get a good shot. Yeah. So I'll tell you what we use for this.
Okay.
What is the name of that? We use a quadcopter. We bought one that was a little pricier than the inexpensive ones you see on the market. What is our UAV? What is it? John's out getting me lunch, so he's the expert on the UAV. Oh, here it comes.
zooming across the room?
Yeah, actually. So this is a very interesting product. I think it's $700. It's called the Phantom. It is a quadcopter because it has four propellers. But the reason that's important is it makes it a very stable platform. It's computer controlled, so they can hover it almost perfectly. In one place. You control it with an iPhone or I think an Android device. Now, this has a mount, a camera mount for a GoPro.
Okay.
That's because we usually shoot video with it, and it looks fabulous. But you could mount another kind of camera to that. Now, if you use the GoPro, you're done because GoPro has a monitoring app that'll use the Wi-Fi in the building that you're in to connect to it and see what it's seeing. So you can literally see what you're going to see, what you're looking at, and then say, I want a picture of that, and then fly the quadcopter to another place, take a picture of that. It's a very stable. Now, here's the downside. First of all, what, about $800? Second of all, which probably isn't too much given your business, I would imagine you get well paid for these kinds of things. And the second issue is battery life. You can maybe get, what, 15 minutes out of this? So if it's going to take you 2 hours to do it, what you'll do is you'll buy extra batteries. That's actually what we did. So you can have four batteries charged up, for instance, and then just swap them out when the battery starts to go down.
Okay. Well, it often will take 2 to 4 hours for me inside of a building.
So buy extra batteries.
Yeah, I understand. I do have a sort of a rigged up tripod mount that I think might be sufficient for me. And I can just sort of...
Wait a minute. You raise it up like a mast?
Yes. And then I can just wheel it over to my next location.
Wow, that's cool. Well, the GoPro, I don't know if the quality is good enough. I don't know what kind of quality you need. GoPro quality is actually pretty good. They do stills as well as video. And they have a Wi-Fi. The GoPro 3 has Wi-Fi built in, which means you can get it on the Wi-Fi network of your customer. You'll have to be on a Wi-Fi network. Use your smartphone to see what you're taking a picture of. And then press the button and go click and move it around, click, 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 and collect all of them. Bring it down, and then it has an SD card that you'd pop out.
Would there be an apparatus where I would not be dependent upon access to my client's Wi-Fi?
Well, Bluetooth only goes 30 feet, so I guess you could use... I don't know of any Bluetooth cameras that give you video. I think you need now with the GoPro. Can he set up the GoPro with its own Wi-Fi? I think it can. The old GoPros did that, where they would be their own Wi-Fi. So that would it's a hotspot. Okay, so that would solve this. You don't have to. You could get on the Wi-Fi network, but the GoPro can also be its own Wi-Fi network.
Okay. What about just hardwiring it with a USB cable?
Well, USB can only go maybe 20 feet. It's going to be a little tricksy. I would go wireless You know what? The GoPro's the way to go. There are other cameras with Wi-Fi. In fact, who just announced a Wi-Fi version of the Olympus TG2? I think it was. Oh, no, it's a Fujifilm. Anyway, there's a compact camera with Wi-Fi also.
Okay.
You could also use the iFi, E-Y-E-F-I. That's a... No, but that won't... No, 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 no. You want something that's going to give you live feedback. So I take it back.
Exactly.
The GoPro is the only thing I know of that will give you live feedback, that you can see what you're looking at and then give it a signal, take a picture of that.
Okay.
GoPro is small enough. You could put it on that tripod. It's not very heavy. It has a tripod mount. So you could raise it up and hold it right there. Look at your smartphone. See what you're seeing. Go take that picture. Move it around. Take that picture. I think that's perfect for you.
Would it be also possible to hook it up to my laptop so I've got a bigger visual of it?
And I should say that professional photographers do this all the time with their DSLRs. They attach a wireless connector to the DSLR that feeds Lightroom or some other program on their laptop. They take a picture, and that's because they want to do what you want to do, which is review the picture on the big screen before they take another one.
Yes, exactly.
So there's a lot of ways to do this for pros. I mean, if you want to use a good camera, the Olympus EP5 apparently has live view and can do this. Many good cameras, you can buy a wireless view on it. That's what pros do all the time. So I think that that's probably the most most sensible way to do it, because you're going to get good quality.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I sure appreciate that.
You're welcome. And we're going to put a link in the show notes to a Vimeo video from Jono in the chat room for somebody who does exactly this, so you can see his stuff. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
That'd be excellent. Thank you.
This is, I'll show you right now. This is cool. This is using the quadcopter, so it's not quite the same. But this is what you can do with this copter that we have. And guess where this is?
No, I turned wrong. Left your heart torn. Is that what devils do? Took you so long. Where only fools gone. I shook the angel and you. Now I'm rising from the ground. Rising up to you.
Go in there. That's a turkey. These are gorgeous. I should bring the Phantom with me on my trip. Take it off the plane. I mean, the boat. Sure, they don't mind. The Phantom is really an amazing thing. And see how steady it is? That's what's really cool about it. It's amazingly smooth. And these are all GoPro shots.
That's amazing.
Probably flying a drone over Istanbul is a bad idea. You're right, Dr. Monk.
I need to know now.
That's scary. Abby would get scared. She doesn't like heights. We were watching once, and they were climbing the beanstalk. She says, it's too scary. I can't watch this. Santa Maria de Luca. Beautiful. This is why I travel. That's high. That's about the limit right there.
Outer space.
Yeah. I think we were able to get 200 feet, something like that. Yeah, we're getting a few beach days in Greece. It's a nice trip because there's some beach, some history, some cities, some country. It's going to be a nice mix. Really excited. That's brave, because it's so easy to lose your Phantom. This is the Phantom. This is the one we have. And a GoPro. Oh. Have we tried that, John, where you turn off the transceiver and it comes back to you?
Yeah. Well,
does it work?
My experience is it gently lands wherever it is.
It just gently lands wherever it is.
But it could have been that it didn't properly get... I've only tested it once.
Right. Get a fix on you before it left.
Yeah.
So there's a GPS in this thing?
Right.
You're kidding me. This thing is amazing. And they probably, there it is. There's the shadow of it. They probably have, this is not the high-end version of it.
Yeah.
This is $800, but this is great. I'm so glad we bought this.
New version.
Needles convinced us.
It has a built-in camera that you can pan and tilt.
Oh, a pan and tilt camera. Yeah, that's what he's obviously doing, right? Because some of this he'll fly over and...
You can buy attachments for this one for pan and tilt.
Oh, okay, see? Whoa. I'm getting queasy. Here. So beautiful. And it's so smooth. That's what's amazing. And the GoPro is so amazing, really.
Yeah.
In other words, get a Phantom copter and a GoPro, yeah. Fly around the world, taking pictures from up in the air. We really had a good time playing with this GoPro. The GoPro is really amazing. I mean, considering how small it is, the quality's excellent. And you put it on one of these Phantom copters, and you've just got a platform that can go 200 feet in the air and get amazing shots. Not what our caller needed. He's already got a tripod. He just needs a camera he can talk to. Lots of choices there. Can we put some links to in the show notes to these various Vimeo videos of the quadcopters flying around? Dr. Mom said, I probably shouldn't bring one. I'm going to Istanbul. I probably shouldn't bring one. It's too near Syria. Probably a bad idea, right? Maybe I should just keep that to myself. 8888 Ask Leo. Ann is in Reseda, California, our next caller. Hi, Ann.
Hi there, Leo.
Welcome to the show.
Wow. Long wait. Yesterday,
sorry.
Today.
You're patient.
Okay.
You're patient. Thank you.
My question. Or I guess I should tell you what's going on. I have an old computer. I'm an old lady. And something came up on it from Cybercrime Division Alliance accusing us of doing all kinds of illegal things and watching things that it's impossible to watch.
You know what happened that was kind of funny? There's a guy who saw this and got freaked out, and he brought his computer to the police department.
Uh-huh.
And he turned himself in. I think you've already figured out this is not the FBI.
No.
This is not the Department of Justice. You know how you know? Because they want you to go down to the neighborhood 7-Eleven.
That's right.
And get money pack coupons and send it to them.
Yep, for $300 to release our computer for ransom.
Yeah, this is called ransomware. It is, of course, not only is it not the FBI, it's illegal in and of itself. You've got malware on your system.
Yeah.
Now, the problem is, you're not going to like this, but once you get malware on your system, you really need to start over.
We did.
Oh, good.
That we have somebody in the family that's pretty informed on computers.
Right on.
He came over and took care of it for us yesterday.
I am so happy to hear that. That's great.
We remember hearing something, my son and I, and I would really love you to talk to him if possible.
Okay.
We heard you say something about a phone number to call if things like this happen about a fraud. But we
There's nothing you can do about this.
There's nothing you can
do. No.
There's nobody to report it to?
No, they don't care. They don't. You can report it, but so what? It's like, so here's the deal. First of all, it's very hard to figure out where it came from. The FBI did arrest, with the help of Interpol, a group of Bulgarian hackers who were doing this.
Uh-huh.
But they weren't the guys who invented it. This is the problem. Somebody invented this and sells it.
Right.
And the hackers customize it. If you were in England and you got this, it would say that Scotland Yard had, hijacked your computer. So there's many, many groups that do this. These Bulgarian hackers made millions of dollars from people who literally sent them money.
I don't doubt it, but I'm not that stupid.
Thank you. Oh, Ann, I'm so thrilled. Yeah. So, no, there's nothing. There's no point in reporting it. It's like reporting spam. Oh. There's nobody. Nobody's going to. There's so much of it. There's nothing to do about it.
Okay. We thought we.
Well, I may have said at some point the U.S. Secret Service and so forth. But the truth is, you know, nobody really cares.
Yeah.
It's like saying, my stereo got stolen out of my car. They'll take the report. But do you think they're going to go look for it?
Of course not.
No. And in this case, there's really nothing. There's nothing. You were smart. You didn't get ripped off.
No.
So I think that there's nothing really to say. It's just, here's the thing to say, Ann. Here's how you keep that from happening. You make sure you keep your system up to date.
Right. And mine wasn't.
Yeah. And that's why.
It is now.
Good. You've got a tech guy in the family. That's what everybody needs, a tech guy in the family.
All right. So you're well aware of this thing that's going on.
Oh, man. I get a call every week from it.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so...
Thank you. You've reported it to me. I'm going to write this... Wait a minute, Ann. Let me write this down. Okay. Ann got bit. Okay. I've made a report now. And I'll send this off to my superiors.
Okay. Oh, one other thing. It seemed only to be happening on Internet Explorer.
Well, it happens.
Do anything with the computer at all. But my son tried SeaMonkey, and we got on.
Yeah. Yeah.
He did a recovery and on the computer and went to SeaMonkey.
Yeah.
We're going to eliminate Internet Explorer.
No, you can't. First of all, you can't. It's built into Windows. There's nothing you can do about it.
Oh, you can't do
if
that.
If you keep your system up to date, you use the latest version of Internet Explorer, you're all right.
Mm-hmm.
The reason it was Internet Explorer... bad guys get into your system through the internet, right? Obviously.
Right.
They're not coming into your house and sitting down.
No.
So anything that goes out on the internet.
Computer camera.
But when you go out on the internet, you're going out there and the bad guys are saying, come here, come here, come here. And if you have a flaw, if you're using IE6, an old version, for instance, the bad guys go, oh, they rub their hands with glee. We have another one. Quick. Hey, Dimitri, look. This lady using old browser.
Yeah.
Quick, jump on system.
Uh-huh.
So that's all. It's not particularly Internet Explorer. I like Google's Chrome browser. I mean, I would use that instead.
Yeah.
It keeps itself up to date for one thing, which Internet Explorer does not.
Uh-huh.
So it's not IE particularly, as long as you keep it up to date.
Okay, we thought it was.
Nah.
But we have straightened out the problems.
Yeah. And now here's the bad news. Here's the bad news. You're probably running Windows XP, aren't you?
Yeah.
In April, Microsoft has announced it's not going to fix it anymore.
Uh-huh.
So at that point, save your pennies now. And then in April, you might want to get a newer computer with a new operating system.
Well, that's right. But the family member that worked on it said this is really a nice computer and everything is good in it. And it's a shame to throw it out. But
well, you know what you could do, Ann, is put a newer version of Windows on it. If the family member really feels that way, say, oh, I just don't know what to do. I wonder if Windows 7 would work. And he'll, oh, yes, it will. I'm going to put it on there for you.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. And okay, then so Windows 7.
I've heard too many bad things about Windows 8.
Yeah, I would go with Windows 7. It'll be just like XP, so you'll know how to use it. And they're going to keep that up to date for another 8 years.
Uh-huh. Great.
All right?
Right. Okay.
Hey, I'm sorry it took so long to get through, but I appreciate your calling.
I got hung up on last night right after you went off the air.
Yeah, we just once we're done, we're done. And I'm so sorry, Ann, but thank you for your patience. I really appreciate it.
Okay, nice talking to you.
Nice to talk to you.
Have a good vacation. Be safe.
Thank you, I will.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
I'm going to strap my money to my butt so I don't have to worry about that. Lil in New York. Is this my Lil? Is this Diamond Lil? Is this Lil Banchick? Dr. Mom, a.k.a.? Hello, Dr. Mom.
How you doing?
I am great. It's so nice to talk to you.
Okay, well, this is the yearly call. Maker Faire is in New York this coming weekend.
I love Maker Faire. We just had a little mini Maker Faire yesterday in our area, and Michael went. It's great for the kids, isn't it?
It is. This year, we're doing things like we're having a giant fountain powered by Coca-Cola and Mentos.
That's where I first saw the Mentos guys, was at a Maker Faire.
The reason I called in, though, this year was they're going to be broadcasting the Innovation Stage Talks live.
Hang on, Dr. Mom. And I want to get the address in just a second. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Chris Marquardt, our photo guy, is here. Digital photography guru. We're going to talk to him in a moment. I don't want to give Dr. Mom short shrift. She'll give me a shot or something. So Dr. Mom, the Maker Faire, which is a wonderful event, and you can find out more at makerfaire@the.com, is coming to the New York area. Did you say next weekend?
It's next weekend. It's Saturday and Sunday at the New York Hall of Science. And they're streaming the Innovation Stage speeches live at makerfaire.org/live.
Oh, that's neat.
And really of importance, the reason I called in, for the teenagers and their parents, Sunday morning, 11 a.m., the assistant dean of admissions from MIT is going to be on that stage talking about how to include your maker experience in the college application.
How to get into MIT by building robots. I like it.
Exactly.
Now, Dr. Mom, you go there. You're a maker. What do you do at the Maker Faire?
I teach at the National Needle Arts Association booth. So we teach needlework, knitting, crochet, and believe it or not, a lot of good studies that show correlation between able to read the charts, that you need to do this, eye-hand coordination, mathematical ability and such.
You know, I think sometimes people think, oh, Maker Faire, it's geeks only, it's only robots and stuff. And no, it's knitting, crochet, it's anything you do with your hands. And they are doing a little bit on quadcopters. They're going to show you how to make your own quadcopter. So this is cool. MakerFaire.com. You said .org. I see .com, but...
You may be right. I think it's .com.
Yeah, MakerFaire, because Disney now sponsors it. Isn't that cool?
Well, Friday, it's private. It's for all of us where they're setting up. They're going to try and set the world's record for paella in the single pan. And we get to eat it afterwards.
Giant paella! And the
paella
Maker
party
Faire.
After the setup.
Dr. Mom, always a pleasure. Thanks so much.
Okay, bye.
Take care. Bye-bye. Chris Marquardt is here, our photo guy. Before we get, we're going to run out of time, so maybe I'll give you an extra segment. But before we get to the topic of the day, you heard our caller. He inspects like beams and struts, structural integrity of warehouses, 20 feet in the air. He has a 20-foot tripod he can actually hold over his head, but he wants a way with his Windows 8 laptop on the ground to see what the camera on the end of the tripod's seeing, so that he can point it at the right place. And they say, take that picture. Don't pros do this all the time?
Well, some do. I'm not sure if you can do it with a laptop, but I've seen pros do it
wirelessly with Lightroom on their laptop. They take a picture, boom, it shows up in Lightroom. They say,
Yeah, that's called tethered shooting. You can also get the live feed from the display out through an AV cable, but you could also use one of those modern Wi-Fi enabled cameras that can let you download an app onto your smartphone, and then you'd be able to see the live screen on that. The new Olympus, for example, does that. Canon has the 6D that does that. So
this is something pros do a lot, tethered shooting, yes. Sometimes wired, yes. Sometimes not. I'm very excited about this new Olympus. As you know, I'm an OMD fan, and this new one, the EM1, has...
There's also a tool out there called Cam Ranger, which lets you hook up Wi-Fi to your camera, and then you can look at the live view of at least Nikons and Canons on your smartphone.
Yeah. I just think this is something that a lot of people are doing, not with a 20-foot tripod, but this is pros do this all the time because they want to see the image and adjust the lighting, turn the model's head a little bit, and then shoot again.
It's a great idea, yeah.
Yeah, it's better than Polaroids. Remember that? People used to do Polaroids of the setup and say, okay, now we can shoot it. So, Chris, you're going to help me because I'm about to leaving Tuesday for Venice. And yes. Then on Sunday, sailing to the Greek islands, and then to Turkey, to Istanbul and Ephesus. So tell me, my friend, help me. I want to get great pictures. Any advice?
First of all, always the question, what do you take on such a trip? And I thought long and hard about especially you and your special case of gear acquisition syndrome.
I have way too much.
You want to take lots, but I would say what you take on such a trip, how much gear you take, kind of hinges on who you're going with. Are there mostly photographers with you, or is
just
it
my
your
sweetie.
Friends or
just
family
my sweetie.
Or
just,
board? Nope. Okay.
Just me and my sweetie. And what we did 6 months ago is we both bought Olympus OMD EM5 cameras, matching cameras. We're going to share our lens set so we don't have to get double lenses.
And that's dangerous. That is dangerous. Guess why? Because you will see the same thing and you'll go, oh, I need the 24. And she will go, I need the 24 too. So you'll be fighting over the
that's
same
okay.
equipment.
That's okay. At least we have our own bodies. And
That's why my sweetheart has Nikon. I'm on Canon, so we never have that problem.
Saves us a lot of money. I don't have to buy double lenses. I think we'll work it out. But that's nice because we have had 6 months to learn how to use it. We didn't just kind of buy it today. And
That will be my next tip. If you get a new camera, don't buy it like a day before the trip.
Because you
will need time to familiarize yourself with it to kind of learn the ropes, where the buttons are, what they do, and that kind of stuff.
And then, because we both are going to be photo buffs, that's nice because she's not going to get – there's nothing worse than not being a photographer with a bunch of photographers because they stop for everything. They say, oh, wait, and they spend half an hour looking at a bug on the sidewalk, and it's the worst. So – we'll both be in that mode.
I usually say photographers are sticky.
Yeah.
They just get stuck everywhere.
Exactly.
Every little blade of grass.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there you go. So I'll be going with another photographer.
This is good. So that pretty much means you will have someone who's understanding if you get the third lens out and change lenses. You don't need time for that, or try this different camera or the next gadget. So that'll be fine. In general, though, you know me. I tend to travel light. I tend to go with just as little as possible, a camera, a kind of an all-rounder lens on my full-frame camera. That would be like a 24 to 105 lens, something along that range has worked quite well. Maybe a little close-up lens that you can put on the front. So just the bare essentials for me. But then with, I know you won't do that. So you will take more with you. I think what's really important is you're gonna have a lot of spontaneous type of photography. Right. You will see things and go, oh, I need to take a shot of this and that. Have the camera ready. I think that's really the thing. Don't have it in your bag, in the never quite ready bag. Leave the lens cap off. Keep it switched on and standby. Have it in your hand. Have it in your hand. So you're ready to take that shot. If something cool happens, you don't want to spend 10 seconds to get the camera ready.
I think this is what I'm going to do. I got one of these little Lowell small camera bags that you zip around. It's a single, kind of bike messenger strap.
And the diagonal ones.
Yeah, they're really great. And I'm going to put the nice thing about that Olympus, it's little, it's small, it's light. I'm going to put that in there with whatever lens I feel like I'll be using that day, probably kind of the medium zoom. And then a couple of lenses. These lenses are tiny. A couple more lenses in there. And then maybe I did get the Olympus TG2, which is a rugged camera that can go in the water, underwater, go in the sand, go in the beach. So I'll have that for beach work. Beach work.
Sounds good.
And I'm going to stop there. I'll leave the 5D at home.
So you leave the quadcopter at home as well.
The quadcopter would be so cool in Venice, though.
We had one on a workshop. It's fun.
Isn't it neat? Fun.
Yes, absolutely.
And you think I should leave the GoPro at home too?
Well, that doesn't take up much space. Maybe a charger. You might strap it to your forehead.
I did. I get the head strap.
On one of the last Himalayan treks, we had a participant who had a GoPro strapped to his forehead for the entire trek.
That doesn't look at all dorky.
So he ended up with a long... No, it didn't. So we get lots of attention that way.
All right. So while I'm gone, we're going to give people a little extra time to do the photography assignment. What's our assignment this week or this month?
The assignment is loud.
Loud! Well, loud. I shouldn't say that because it might not be a loud voice. It could be a loud shirt. It could be.
I've seen some rather loud pictures already. So,
Here's the deal: we want you to take new pictures. This is just a chance to go out and take shots. Tag them with the word "loud." Upload them to our tech guy group at flickr.com. And when I get back, we'll do a review, and I will take some loud pictures. Thank you, Chris Marquardt. So Blip says in the EM5 with a 714 and a 1250. I have almost every lens. So I even have the pinhole lens that is the lens cap pinhole camera, which is wild.
What's your favorite wide angle lens? Like real wide angle? I'm talking 11 millimeters.
I have the 17 pancake, which is effective 34. I would like a little wider than that, but it's a pancake. So it's very compact. So that probably will be the lens I'll keep on all the time. And that's wide enough for, building photography.
You know, if I went Micro Four Thirds, I would instantly try to find a good tilt shift adapter and then put a DSLR lens on it. They are available. So that would be my way to go, but I'm a nerd anyway, so.
Oh yeah, here it is. Look at that. This is new. I hadn't seen this. I wonder if there's time to get it. It's from Kaipon.
If you haven't played with the tilt shift adapter before, you need to practice that.
This is nice because it's just a tilt shift adapter that you then put other lenses on.
But you need a bigger lens. You can't then use a Micro Four Thirds lens. You would need to use a DSLR lens because that has a bigger image circle, and that's what you need for the shifting. So and then it adds bulk again, and then all the advantages are, or most of the advantages are gone. So
I have two really lovely lenses that I like on the OMD. One is a 45 millimeter f1.4 or 1.8, I can't remember.
Oh, that sounds good.
And so that's effective 90, and then one is a 70. Actually, the best lens I have is the 75, which is a beautiful lens. But that's a little long, and I think Venice is going to be a little bit. I think I need a wide in Venice.
Yeah, I'm a wide-angle guy. So.
Yeah. But the 45 and the 75 are really nice lenses, very well-made Olympus lenses. So I love those. So I'll probably have one of the, you know, that's for portraiture, right? That's for low-light portraiture.
Oh, that works for even for landscape. You can shoot landscapes with, if you're far away enough, you can shoot landscapes with long
lenses.
Well,
when I go to places like Ephesus where it's wide open, or the Greek islands where it's wide open, yeah, maybe there. But yeah. I think in Venice, it's these narrow little streets and stuff. I think wider is what I want.
If you shoot wide angle, make sure you get something in the foreground. You get close to like a boulder or a bush or something to give the picture more layers and more depth.
Right. Because you don't want to just be all out there, yeah.
It happens, and then yeah. Later on those shots will look really boring. So it's easy to get that wrong.
I should see which. I'll show you which MFT lenses I have.
Okay, I cannot see anything right now.
Your pictures. Yeah, we do this every time with you. I don't know why.
Yeah, well, as long as you get my sound.
Yeah, well, you sound great, and you looked great actually. So MFT, I have all the Olympus ones. I think I don't think I have.
Yes, you're back now.
Just trying to see which ones I have. Oh, there's a wide-angle converter. I don't know if I want to do that. Yeah, we have the 4150, which is equivalent 80 to 300. Lisa loves mm-hmm. that. She likes shooting really long.
It's shooting long makes it much easier because you end up leaving stuff out of the picture, being able to kind of simplify the pictures this way. So long lenses. If I'm a wide-angle guy, but again, I'm a strange person anyway. So. When it comes to photography, but initially longer lenses are definitely a better choice because your pictures will just turn out much. The pictures will be stronger most of the time.
Yeah, actually, I think she has a 45-200, which is effective 90 to 400. Mm-hmm. That's the one she has. She loves that. She gets great shots with that.
Oh yeah, oh, so oh yeah.
She'll probably have that one on most of the time. That. Yeah. All right. Thank you, Christoph.
Okay. Cool. Talk to you in a few weeks.
See you later. Thanks for pre-recording.
Take care.
With me.
Safe travels.
All righty. By the way, I didn't mention Chris Marquardt does great workshops. DiscoverTheTopFloor.com if you want to know more about that. We'll put that in our show notes too at TechGuyLabs.com. Chris Marquardt, our photo guy. He will be here for the next 3 weeks. We have some great segments planned for you, so don't worry. Lots more of that. Kevin is on the line from Calabasas. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hi, Kevin.
Hi, how are you there, Leo?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm doing outstanding, but I'm working on it. I have followed you for years, and I know Johnny Jett well.
I'm
actually a speaker, and we've spoken at travel conferences. And he told me to call into you one of these days, and I never got around to it and busy. And I knew you were going over to Italy, and I said, you know, let
last
me
last chance. Call. Yeah. Well, I'm so glad to meet you. What are you in the travel line, Kevin?
Well, I kind of am. I'm kind of a jack of all trades. I'm actually a police detective. I'm a detective sergeant with one of the largest police departments in the United States. And I don't say that because outside the police department, I have a business, and I do speaking for large corporations, and I go in and teach business travelers how thieves steal their laptops.
I need to talk to you.
Cell phones, and so I can't profit off my police department's name, so I just do that. But that's kind of what I do, and I go on TV a lot and do stuff on all the business channels. And I've been listening to your show, and I know that, you know, the tech issue is a big issue for a lot of people throughout the world. You're going overseas, and I'm hearing this going, he's going to Venice. He's going to one of the three top pickpocketing locations in Europe.
Really? Oh, how exciting.
Well, but you want to, it's all in perspective, right? It just,
you know, I'm oblivious, Kevin. Last year I went to Buenos Aires, and I was walking down the street about midnight with my Canon 5D and a giant lens on it on my shoulder. And a very nice Argentinian fellow taps me on the shoulder and said, you shouldn't be here. Go back to your hotel, tourist.
You know, I show video in my presentations actually down in South America on thieves that are so adept. Yeah. I mean, that the best thieves are the best actors and actresses.
Oh, yeah. Well, my friend John C. Dvorak was in Spain and put his camera, his phone, and his wallet on the table. A gypsy woman came by, and there was a baby involved, and there's some distractions, and you know, by the time they realized what had happened, it was all gone.
Yep, no, absolutely. And talking about the cameras, the video that I show is that you see as a gentleman's walking down a crowd, a couple of youngsters and you know teenagers came up and actually were able to distract the one gentleman
That's
by
the key.
Bumping into him and unscrew the lens off the camera. Because in a lot of these folks, they can take a look inside you up in a couple seconds. They can look at that camera and know, is this a $1,500 lens or just a cheap, you know?
Oh, yeah, and I have nothing but $1,500 lens. So tell me, Kevin, how should I prepare myself for this? I don't want to be living in fear.
No, absolutely not. And you want to know something, Leo? I got to tell you, as I tell everybody else, there's a lot of folks out there that scare the bejeebers off of people. And I've been saying this for years. I've been with the police department for 33 years, and I travel all over the world, and I stay pickpocketing, you know, in Europe, and I do that on my vacation.
What a hobby.
Yeah, it's just, I'd love to do it, and it's just kind of fun for me. But anyways, I'd like to let you know.
Hey, let me ask you this, because sometimes guys who are expert in this could also do it. Could you like be a really good pickpocket?
Well, I do that in my presentations. I rip off people, but it's kind of hard when everyone's, you know, you get 1,000 people up on the stage, and I caught as a distraction to happen in the audience. And as that's going on, and people are they're looking at this back corner of the auditorium where I'm speaking, because someone maybe and they've had a heart attack, or they've fallen, or I stage like an act of domestic violence, something to get the audience to turn their attention away from me. And then I work the crowd and I start to rip them off, because that's exactly what some thieves do.
Sure.
Just like you said, the friend of yours, is they commit an act.
There was a baby, the baby was crying. It was and the gypsy, and by the time he, you know, realized it was gone.
Yeah, absolutely. But Leo, let me put you at ease with this, along with other folks that this might be of interest, is that in this big blue marble of ours, the majority of people are just honest, law-abiding, hard-working folks.
I agree 100%.
And they are. And just there's always this small group of people. And I don't care if they're politicians, whatever it is.
They often find their way into politics, yes.
In every walk of life, there's a small percentage of folks that are thieves. And what I do is I try to tell folks is that what you need to do is read up and be skilled on how professional thieves operate. And that if you happen to cross paths with this small group of individuals which like to target locations where they have the best hunting grounds, and that's locations where tourists go, because tourists, especially, you know, folks from westernized countries, are ones that carry the most items of value. That's where they like to hunt. You don't go hunting where there's nothing of value. So if you spend a little bit of time and learn how they operate, learn the most common distractions, if you were to cross paths with them, you're probably going to reduce your, I call it risk reduction, and you're going to reduce your chances to have them target someone else that they're just not paying attention, and kind of like yourself a little bit. And even as the last thing I'll share with you before we go on to some strategies here is that, you know, the majority of people haven't fallen victim to theft when they travel throughout the world, even the domestic United States.
I've never been robbed, and I've traveled a huge amount to everywhere in the world, Cairo, Buenos Aires, all sorts of places. Never been robbed.
Reaffirms what I'm saying, and that's because...
In fact, it's more people like that guy, who tapped me on the shoulder, said, you know, you shouldn't really be walking around with that 5D.
Yeah, so that's...
Nice people.
We're trying to protect ourselves from that small group of people that have a huge amount of people to select from, and that's why most of us haven't fallen victims. So that's what we want to talk about a little bit, about how to reduce those chances even more from falling victim. And
good. We have a couple of minutes, so give me some strategies.
Yeah, so let's go ahead and start off with smartphone theft, because smartphone theft, I've heard you talk about it, that's the number one item that's stolen from people that travel worldwide.
They're small, they're light, they're easy to steal because they're usually just in a pocket, and they're worth a lot of money.
Yeah, absolutely. As a matter of fact, if you go into YouTube and you just, you know, search up, you know, hijacked, you know, that's what we deem it.
Hijacking.
It's called hijacked. We also call it apple picking in the law enforcement world. And that's where thieves just come up and just they're looking for different ways. So let's talk about the most typical, and that's going to be the distraction. At a sidewalk cafe, you could be anywhere in throughout the world, but usually tourist locations. You got your phone on the table, you're having a little latte, a cup of coffee, a glass of wine, and somebody comes up to you and distracts you and has a map or asks you for directions to the right side of your table. And your phone is kind of off to the left side. And then somebody else comes up that appears to be with them, and they have a newspaper or a map. And as you are talking to the person that's asking you questions, saying, do you speak English? They set the
other right on top. That's exactly what the gypsy did.
Yep. And what they do is they put it on top of your phone. And, of course, you and your travel partner are distracted by this person.
Right.
I mean, they use, I mean, the videos that I show, as you see, it's a woman that's in her 70s, right?
It was a little old lady. Exactly.
Absolutely. I've had them with children, or when they come up and say, do you speak English? Can you help me? And all travelers want to help each other. So that's number one, is that know that anything you leave on your table is of high risk when you're in a location that has a lot of tourists, because that's what they love to target, okay, number one. Number two, you want to be careful of your purse, your travel bag, anything you put your items in. The worst place to put a cell phone or item of value is going to be in a purse in the back of a chair. It's so easy to do the distraction there. You want to be able to put your arm or put your leg through your travel bag, whatever it is, so they just can't distract you and pick up your bag and walk away.
Yeah, I always do that. I always have, and I even do that in the States here in Petaluma. I always have it like hooked onto me. Yep. Yeah.
I have a video that's outside of Paris, France, a small sidewalk cafe, the security camera that's there shooting, and there's two, a man and a wife having a cup of coffee at a small sidewalk cafe with a tiny little topiary out front, like a shrub out front, and they've got their purse and their camera on the empty chair next to them, which is back against this little landscape hedge. You actually see a hand come through the hedge and take the cell phone and take the travel bag off there as the people are faced in the opposite directions and as those look there. So be very careful anything you lay down as far as that. The last kind of one I'd just like to leave you on is just a little tip is that know that any bag you carry, like a day bag or a backpack, anything like that you want to carry on your shoulders, if you're in a subway or you're going to be on the Vaporetto, which by all means is just a great
thing. Oh, I love the Vaporetto, yeah.
Because there's no buses in Venice.
It's the taxi.
Right?
It's the taxi.
It's called the water taxi.
Yeah.
If you watch there, and Leo, we'll talk later on when you get back, take a look for the signs on many of the public Vaporettos. There'll be a picture, an icon, showing the backpack to be worn in front of you, because the thieves unzip your zippers in the back of your small backpacks or day bags.
Yeah.
And they take out your items.
Lisa, like many women, has a backpack purse, which she was planning on taking her. So I'm going to tell her that. Yep.
Okay. But what they want to do, matter of fact, I have a website. It's at corporatetravelsafety.com. You'll see there's an area called backpacks. You want to travel with a backpack that has zippers that you can lock down with little carabiner clips. So they cannot unzip the zippers without your knowledge. If you don't want to go out and buy a security backpack, which they have a variety of those types of things, simply put little twistums or a tie where they can't just easily unzip the zipper from you.
Kevin, we're out of time, but you are great. We're going to get you back. Thank you so much, Leo Laporte.
Leo, have a great trip.
Tech guy. Thank you. That was awesome.
Oh, Leo, there's a bunch of other stuff that...
you can keep going because we're on the podcast now. The radio's gone off, but there's still people...
Oh, my God. I'm so happy to do this.
You know, Kalisa got a backpack, which I really like, that has a lid that folds over the zipper part and buckles in so that the zippers are protected when the buckle's down. But I'm going to still tell her, wear it in front of you, not behind you.
Yeah.
It's just too
easy
to
mention. As a matter of fact, and if you wanted to, and even before you go, Leo, I'd love to help you out, is I have a website that has a whole bunch of videos and locations. And
what's the web? Oh, I'll plug it next hour. What's the website?
Yeah, corporatetravelsafety.com. And that has all of these unique travel products, which you'll see, like security backpacks and such. But you'll see a section called Travel. I don't know if you're on there now.
I am.
Okay, so let me actually go to myself.
I actually wish I'd known about this sooner because it's really I'm leaving Tuesday. But
you want to know something? There might be something I can do to help you out.
No, that's all right. It's okay. I think, like I said, I've never been ripped off because I think I naturally do all of these things that you're talking about. I wear Scotty vest stuff, which all of the pockets are inside the jacket and zipped closed. And I feel very safe. Even if somebody were to come up and kind of put their hands on me, I am very aware of this kind of stuff. So I've been lucky.
Johnny Jett and I wear one also, especially going through the screening.
Oh, it's great.
There's a lot of theft that goes on at the screening stations there at the airport.
I know.
And so that's kind of, but if you go up the very top of the toolbar, you'll see it says travel advice.
Mm-hmm.
Click on travel advice, and then it's going to open up. Actually, the website's running slow, so I take
Why do you think that might be?
But
5,000 people just went there, and it's broken.
Yeah. So on the left-hand side later on, you'll see on the travel advice, it's broken down by category. Then you'll see pickpockets in Italy. And there's an area called pickpockets in restaurants, and you'll see exactly how they rip you off.
Oh, that's great.
In the restaurants, you see videos, actual crime footage, showing as you're sitting there with a party of 8 or 10 people, you're going to be at having dinner together, and you see a couple coming next to you, and the woman just reaches down, takes your wife, your girlfriend's purse, and slides up, and you're not even paying attention.
So it's amazing, isn't it?
you'll kind of see that there. So, you know, the best, as I mentioned there, the best thieves are the best actors and actresses. Yeah. They don't walk around with a stocking cap pulled over their head and all shit.
Of course not.
They look like you and I. And they just blend into the environment.
I'll show you what they look like. Come here. They look like this woman right here. This is a definitely a thief in the making. This, why? Look at her top hat there. Like, we're getting advice, Lisa, on what to do in Venice not to get pickpocketed. He said you should wear your backpack in front of you like a baby Bjorn.
Oh, I have a little hideaway wrist waist thing that goes in my pants.
She's going to wear a money belt.
Yeah. So my backpack.
And you want to put that in the inside.
Inside her pants. Yeah, that's what
you never. Yeah. You never, of course, for a woman you don't, but you never put your wallet in the back pocket.
No, I never. I always in the hip pocket, even like I said, when I'm walking around here. And, of course, in Venice, I'll put it in my Scotty vest.
Hey, there you go. You know, yeah. You know, we call the back pocket. The back pocket's called the sucker pocket.
Sucker pocket. I'm going to suck it right out of there.
The sucker pocket. but, you know, there's just when you start to take a look at cell phone theft, I mean, that's just, it's such a huge issue in Europe. That's, again, why, you know, they're looking at Apple as putting on the
that's the fingerprint reader. I think that's really the response. I know police departments have been saying for a long time to Apple, you got to do something about
it. We're doing
this.
It for all cell phone companies. Yeah. We just despise it because they're sold and they've done these things, you know, across the board. You know, you start to take a look. You take a look at Absolute Software. They're one of the big trackers of cell phone theft and such. And they report that, you know, coffee shops are the number one location where phones reported stolen from, and then it's bars. Of course, we're talking about the United States. But see, this is the interesting thing, Leo, is that a lot of times is that we're not even notified of these thefts.
Sure.
If it's an older phone, the people don't make a claim with it.
Right.
They have to make the claim if they have insurance. But
you only see the tip of the iceberg, I'm sure.
Yeah. And that's the issue. Is a lot of folks, when they're victimized, they don't even make a police report, especially overseas.
Should they?
Absolutely. 100% absolutely. Matter of fact, I'll even digress here a little bit. We're going to talk about your camera. Is that one of the things that we do, and I've done over the years, when we'll take down a thief that was stealing, you know, cameras out of hotel rooms, out of the back of rental cars, another big issue for travelers domestically and overseas, is that, you know, we find this stuff in their home, we find their stuff in their car. Your name's not on it. So what we do is we contact the manufacturer, and we ask the manufacturer to run the serial number. But that sad part is most folks don't register their electronic goods with the manufacturer, which was one of the first places we turn to if they haven't registered as stolen with the police department.
So I should, before we go, I should write down our serial numbers on all of these devices.
Absolutely.
Keep
now,
with us.
With cell phones, you're pretty good, right? Because you're going to have the ESN numbers, and that's going to help us out. Right. You know, once you go overseas, though, it's like night and day. I mean, sometimes, unless it's extremely difficult. Like, I show a slide when I was over in Spain. Barcelona is probably the largest city for pickpockets in the world, especially on Las Ramblas, which is the main drag.
I have spent much time on Las Ramblas, and I love it. I love it. It's one of my favorite cities in the world. Yeah.
I love to shoot the video of the pickpockets that work there. And of course, they're all young gypsy kids.
Well, everybody warned me about it, so I was totally prepared in Barcelona. And I just was careful because everybody said, watch out for Las Ramblas. And we were there late at night because that's when the party starts. And
I show a picture of the police station, the tourist police station there in Barcelona, off Las Ramblas, on a Monday morning. And there's 25 people in line to make police reports on the Monday morning. And again, for to replace their passports and different things.
Here. Well, and that's the big issue. The good news is the boat keeps the passports, and I think that's why they don't want to have this problem.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's where, you know, you take...
So do you recommend not keeping your passport on your person?
No, you don't need it. Here's the nice thing about it, and this is one of the other things. I work for a lot of large oil companies, the largest ones in the world, where they bring me in to teach their international travelers and their drillers and their stuff like that over in Russia, is that with smartphones, you can take pictures of everything. I mean,
I do. I have a picture of everything in my Evernote.
Absolutely. Yep. And then you've got it locked down. And this is the thing now I'm telling folks, you need to sanitize your wallet. You need to remove your AAA card, your Nordstrom's card, your Union 76 gas station card. You don't need that when you're going overseas.
Yes.
And then you take pictures of your medical card, the most important stuff.
Yes.
So if your phone does get stolen, you can go to your website, download it, pull it down, as long as you have everything encrypted. And, you know, your carbonite. I mean, I know they're one of your advertisers, but I'm a big proponent of theirs. Everything needs to be backed up. Yep. I always tell folks, you need to prepare that your home's going to get broken into, your car's going to get broken into, you're going to lose something when you're on the road, and it needs to be secured and backed up.
Kevin, I got to run. Thank you, Detective. This is great stuff. I really appreciate it.
We'll talk in the future.
All right. I would love to get you back on. People loved it.
Let me talk to your partner there.
You want to talk to Heather? All right, put you on hold if I can figure out. It's a magic thing. I do this and I do this. I think I got it. Okay. I got the magic trick. I never know how this stuff works. Hello. Welcome. Welcome to you all. Why'd you move over in the corner there? You're very kind. Aren't you nice? Aren't you sweet? Now you got obstructed view, but every once in a while I'll just go like this so you know I'm still here. Welcome, everybody. We had a few more people join us. That's nice. Yeah, the boat won't let you take the passport unless you get to a country where they expect you to have it. So in Russia, for instance, I had to have my passport with me. I got a special passport wallet that has a little pen in it so I can fill out forms. I've never been pickpocketed or robbed or anything, and I've gone to some nasty places. Do not want to lose your passport. Jennifer lost her passport in Paris. We had to fly home without her. And it's a pain to get a new one. But I always make pictures of all of the passports. Always have those with me. And as long as you have that, it's a lot easier. Well, hey, how are you today? Leo Laporte here, hour three of the Tech Guy Show. I wanted to thank Kevin, the police detective who called us and gave us some tips at the end of the last hour. I wish we'd had more time for traveling abroad and protecting yourself, but I can forward you to his website. He's got a lot of material there and stuff you can buy to, you know, like special wallets and backpacks and stuff that are traveler safe. CorporateTravelSafety.com. So I'm glad to give you a little plug there, Kevin. I appreciate all the information. CorporateTravelSafety.com. Worry-free travel gear for your peace of mind. That's a great idea. That is a great idea. Hotel security, backpacks, TSA locks, travel purses. I hate for people to be paranoid. And as I said, I've never been robbed. And I've traveled quite a bit. I love to travel. It's my favorite thing in the world. And I usually travel with big, fancy cameras. People are pretty nice. I've yet to be robbed. I'm sure that's just luck. But I certainly do everything I can to be sensible, but not paranoid. 8888-ASK-LEO. That's the phone number. And Rico is in Ontario, California. Hi, Rico.
Yes, sir.
How are you?
I'm pretty good, man. Just working.
Just working at, working, having a good time. What's up?
Yes, sir. I was just listening to your radio station, and I have a question for you.
Okay.
And probably can help me. So what happened is that my little kid lost my iPod. I lost my iPod. And what happened is I have all the pictures, memories, and a lot of videos on it. And then the problem was also that I just noticed that my iCloud was now activated. And then I don't know, how can I retrieve my pictures?
So the device is lost?
Yes.
And it wasn't backing up?
It wasn't backing up on iTunes.
So you're out of luck, because even if you were to activate iCloud now, there's nothing on it. Yes, bad news, I'm afraid, Richard. I wish, Rico, I wish I could give you better news. But if you can't find the device, did you ever hook it up to a computer?
I did. But.
So one possible little bit of light at the end of the tunnel here. One of the things that iTunes does, if you ever hook it up to iTunes, is it will back up your device. So if you had it ever had it hooked up to your iTunes, I would go and look and see if you have a backup on iTunes of that stuff. The of course, restoring it means you're going to have to get a same device, get another iPod just like that. Yeah, pictures, I don't know. I think your pictures, you're kind of out of luck. Unless you were using iPhoto. iPhoto will back it up on a Mac. That's the only place to look at this point and see if the computer backed it up. On all Apple devices, there's two kinds of backup. You can do local backup using iTunes on your computer. And you could do iCloud, cloud backup. You know, I really should probably mention iCarbonite right now. I'm sorry, Rico. I hate to be the bearer of bad tidings. It's terrible. George is coming up in Houston. He wants to know the difference between a geek and a nerd. I can define that. Before we do, though, let me... I love the question. Thank you. Let me talk a little bit about our great friends at Carbonite Online Backup. This would be a perfect time to mention them. If you don't actively back up your stuff, you will eventually lose it. And I don't want you to be calling sad like Rico saying all these pictures, it's all lost. If you only have one copy of something, I don't care where it is, it eventually gets lost or stolen or fails or you. User error is a big issue. Carbonite solves that problem. It solves it. Automatic, continuous, online backup. Now, it won't back up an iPod, but if you back it up to iTunes, it then backs up what's in iTunes. And that's great because, hey, you can lose the iPod, you can lose the computer, and you still got your stuff. It's peace of mind protection. And, boy, is it affordable. $59.99 a year. Less than $5 a month for everything on your computer, Mac or PC. They also have small business plans. They have plans for external drives. Just go to carbonite.com. Pick the plan you want. In every case, they're one low, flat yearly rate for every bit of data you got. And you can try it free. And I recommend you do that for 2 weeks. You don't need a credit card. Just my name, Leo. See how it works. Usually that first 2 weeks is enough to get your first backup set up. And then after that, it'll back up everything as it gets changed or added. Carbonite.com. Use my name, Leo, for the free trial at Mac or PC. And then if you decide to buy, 2 months free with purchase. You got to back it up to get it back. So do it right with Carbonite. Hey, George, Houston, Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Yes, hi there. You have clarified yourself. You corrected yourself a few times on the show saying once that you are a geek, not a nerd.
I am a geek, so, not a nerd.
Yeah. And so have some of your listeners have said the same thing. And I even asked that once on a computer show. I have a decent idea, but what is your take on that?
That's a great question. I do think there's a difference between a geek and a nerd.
Okay.
Nerd, I think, describes a social demeanor. It's somebody who is probably an introvert, is a little bit uncomfortable in social settings. Maybe now geeks often look nerdy, so that's where the confusion is. Some geeks are nerds, but not all geeks are nerds. A geek, in my opinion, and the way I use geek, and I say I am a geek, and but I do say you don't have to be a geek to listen to this show, but I do admit to being a geek. A geek, in my definition, and it starts in high school where these terms are, you know, typically assigned. Oh, you're a geek. My kids think I was a geek. They looked at a picture of me in high school and said, geek! A geek is somebody, and this is my definition alone, who cares more about what's going on above the neck than below the waist. And you're in high school. Everybody's thinking about girls or boys, but if you're thinking about chess or Dungeons and Dragons or computers or slide rules or math or anything, particularly in the science and technology area, then you're a geek. Nerds, I think, can be just nerdy. They're people who lack a certain social skill, and they don't necessarily, often do, share a lot in common with geeks, but they don't have to. Now, that's just my kind of distinction. I think a lot of people use the words interchangeably, and I don't think there's any reason to worry about it. It's wow. My point mostly is it's not an insult.
Okay.
You're an okay person if you're a nerd or a geek.
Right. Okay. I was very, very curious about that. That's all.
It's a great question. I appreciate it, George. Are you a geek or a nerd? Which are you?
I'm not even sure. I'd probably say a geek.
And, you know, people sometimes call this show and say, I'm not a geek, but I have a question for you. Believe me, if you're listening to this show, you at least have geek tendencies. You're moving in the geek direction. But that's the point. There's nothing wrong with that. Geeks are cool. Geeks are cooler than ever. Here's a good example. Bill Gates. Now, Bill Gates is a little nerdy. You know, I'm wearing glasses. He's a little nerdy. But more he's geeky because he's really smart and he's passionate. Geeks typically are passionate about something. And they're passionate to the point where they don't care what other people think. That's where the nerd side, because nerds are not great, you know, in social situations. And so geeks, because they don't care what other people think, they will bend your ear about, you know, the comic book that they're into, or the programming language they like, or, hey, they'll be the kind of people who fight you when you say, I don't like Macs. They'll fight you. Those are geeks. I'm very proud to be a geek. I am. But you don't have to be a geek to listen to this show. In fact, what I think my job in life is to be the intermediary between the land of the geeks and the land of the normals. I am the ambassador from the world of geek to you normal people. If you've got a question, I'll be glad to answer it. 888-ASK-LEO. That's the phone number. 888-827-5536. Toll free from anywhere. Our geeky webpage is techguylabs.com. And if you go there, you can get into the chat room, which I have to say is full of geeks. I admit it. You can also get our phone number and questions and answers from all of our previous shows. Techguylabs.com. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. We have a vote. Are you a geek or are you a nerd? Let's see here what's going on. A little straw poll. I am a... Oh, you have to pick one. Oh, you have to be... Can't be both. Geek or nerd? I'm going to say I'm a geek. Let's see what's going. Only... that's pretty equal right now. In fact, it's exactly equal. More geeks. Hey, how are you? I'm a neek. Or are you a gerd? Or am I a gerd? Oh, it's Sunday. What am I doing watching CNN? Holy moly, I can't believe it. Fortunately, the Niners aren't playing till tonight.
I don't have to worry about that. Ooh.
Ooh, do, 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 do. Hot tub fun? No. I want local channels. Fox NFL postgame. There we go. CBS has all the games. You don't have to do that, Spencer. Never do that. Just walk boldly and briskly across the cabras. No crawling.
Leo, I black tape out or gaffer tape on my gear. Like, I'll tape it up.
Tape it up? That's a good idea. To your body?
Well, no, just all the logos off.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I did that. That's a very good idea. I did that. I got rid of the Canon camera strap, of course, or the Olympus camera strap. It's a generic camera strap. The problem is those Canon lenses are so distinctive. So you tape up the red ring, huh?
Yeah, and I really put tape all over and kind of
make it scuff it. Yeah, that's a good idea. Yeah, make your stuff look crappy. Web 3764 says, have you ever been in a fight? You mean a fist fight?
What's your question or comment?
Yeah, I was in a fist fight in sixth grade and I won. Never again. I try to avoid fights. Yeah, it was a slap fight, so that's a fight. The geeks are winning now, big time. Geeks are taking over. Of course, there's only 67 votes, but... I don't want to mess up my nice Canon lenses. I think I'm going to leave my Canon at home and just take the Olympus. It doesn't look like a fancy camera. In fact, it looks like a film camera, which is one of its charms. I am not a Twilight fan. I'm neither Team Jacob nor Edward. So there. I do love my Nexus 7. Yes, I do. The question is, were you ever put in a locker in high school? They couldn't fit me in a locker, so no. Yeah, they might have tried, but they couldn't squeeze me in. Chrome Ham, I have the Olympus OMD EM5. It's the Micro Four Thirds. No need, Dr. Mom, but thank you for the offer. Is this your video, A-Tort? Oh, we did watch this. This is the Utah one. We watched it. A-Tort, you weren't paying attention. Okay. The cosplay song. You can be a sports geek, I think. Yeah, sure. If you ever saw somebody sitting at the baseball game with a scorebook, headphones, the cap with all the buttons on it and all the pins, you know, and I've got my ticket around. Oh, I'm describing myself. My ticket around my neck and the special holder so I don't lose it. My mother made me do that. And I'm scoring every pitch. Yeah, that's kind of geeky.
Baseball's extremely stats heavy.
It is a geeky sport, but you know, football's become that way too. You can score football games. Believe me, the geeks have discovered sports. They don't play it. Please don't mistake us for players. We're merely recorders. We're followers. We're analyzers. Paula, Long Beach, Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hi, Paula.
Hi, how are you?
Great, how are you?
Good, good, fabulous. Because of your review, I now have a Nexus 7 second generation 32 gigabyte. In fact, it was a birthday present from my wonderful husband.
That's a great gift.
Thank you, thank you. Yeah, I'm loving it.
Do you love it?
Just had it for 2 days, looking through it, loving it. But my question and my I'd like your recommendation. We also have, both my husband and I have the same phones, Galaxy 4G, just the Galaxy S.
Yep.
And then at home we have PC, Windows 7.
Okay.
And so therefore, you know, on our home computer, the contacts list, I have that whole contact list. Mm-hmm. On the smartphone, have a contact list.
Yes. Okay, the key here, Google Contacts is your friend.
Okay, Google Contacts.
That's where you want to keep everything. And now you already have a Google account, certainly.
Yes, but I don't use it that much.
Well, you're going to.
Okay.
You don't have to use it for Gmail, but, you know, that's kind of, anybody who has Google Mail has a Google account.
Correct.
But you are going to go to contacts.google.com and calendar.google.com, and you'll say, wait a minute, there's all my contacts. Holy cow, there's my calendar. That's right, because the phones and the tablet automatically synchronize with Google Calendar and Google Contacts. The trick, of course, is to get it on the PC. Now, are you using Outlook?
No.
What do you use for a calendar on the PC?
Well...
Or do you not use a calendar on the PC?
No, I do. It's what's in Windows Live Mail, so... And I don't really use it that much, but there is stuff in there.
Well, what you'd really like is to have your calendar on your desktop look the same as the calendar on the phone.
Yes.
And on the Nexus, and it should all synchronize.
Okay.
Those other Google devices are all synchronizing with calendar.google.com and contacts.google.com now.
Okay.
So, and you should make sure that they are, but that's the default. They automatically do that.
Okay.
The hardest thing is actually getting it to work with Outlook, Microsoft's Outlook. It's not going to be so difficult for you. But Outlook, you need special tools to do that. If you go to live.com, you can. You have a Microsoft account, too.
Right.
And you don't have to use it. Just very similar to the Google accounts. You don't have to use it for email or anything. But you do want to tie your Live account into your Google account. Make sure that they're synchronizing.
Okay.
Then and I'm pretty sure you can do that. Correct me if I'm wrong, chat room, but as far as I know, they still support synchronization. They don't do it with Outlook, but they do support synchronization with the Live calendar. And you know, if you don't want to do that, the easiest thing to do would be to keep your browser, keep a bookmark to calendar.google.com. Actually, that's what I do.
Oh, okay.
Because now that's your calendar.
Okay.
And same thing with your contacts, contacts.google.com. You can just put a bookmark on the desktop. You don't even have to use an application.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, right. Now okay. I see. I saw that click.
Yes, you did.
It was a little aha. But once you do that, your life is so much easier because when you get a new phone, even if it's an iPhone, you just log into your Google account. It all your stuff is in there.
Yeah, and that's what I want. I want a main contact address list.
Yes.
So that when I make changes, all the devices can see it.
Exactly. And Google will do that. Google's set up to do that.
Okay.
And all the Android devices that you have are set up to do that.
Okay.
It's Windows that's a little tricksy. But if you're satisfied, and I am, with the browser being your calendar and your contacts, you got it.
Okay, and so when I'm in Windows Live Mail, I want to send an email.
Then it gets a little trickier. Yeah, so that's why in your Windows Live account, you know, I would use Gmail if I were you, but you want to preserve this stuff. But in that Live account, you can connect accounts to your Live account. And one of the accounts you'll connect is your Google. And then it will automatically import into your Live account.
Okay. Great. Okay.
And vice versa, by the way, which is great.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Have a fabulous trip.
Yeah, thank you so much, Paula. Great to talk to you. And thank your husband for a very nice gift. Those Nexus 7s are lovely little tablets. Kathy in Los Angeles is next. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hi, Kathy.
Hi there, Leo.
Welcome.
Thanks for taking my call. We are having a little slight mental breakdown here with our email service. We have a very small business, but it has expanded over the several years. When we first started it, we started out with a little Yahoo account, and our customers got really comfortable with it, so we've kept it. But over the years, we've accumulated several thousand clients that we correspond mostly through email with, and there's although we're in Los Angeles, our clients are based all over the country. We see them intermittently, and we have to send out email notice to all of them about where we're going to be at what time and schedule. And so we go in and out of places like New York and Boston and New Jersey doing what we do. Yahoo has had some serious meltdown.
I don't like Yahoo Mail. And I wouldn't use Yahoo Mail. Here's what you really should do. I presume you have a website for your business.
We do have a website.
All right. So what you really want to do is have that website, kathyscoolbusiness.com, be your email, too. It should be kathy@kathyscoolbusiness.com, shouldn't it?
Yeah. It should. You're right.
Yeah. Not yahoo.com. Why give them an ad? Not AOL.com. But the good news is you can go to your registrar. Don't have them do the mail. Just have them forward the mail. Any mail that comes to your web address, have them forward it to, and I would recommend Google Mail, but you could choose. You could even use Yahoo Mail. But you can have it forward to whatever mail service you're using.
Okay. So, we are trying to get rid of Yahoo.
And the other advantage of this is, the problem is everybody knows this Yahoo address. Once you've got it to kathyscoolwebsite.com, you can have that forward anywhere. You could change your email provider daily. People don't care because they're sending it to the website.
So how do we do that? What I understand from Yahoo is if you have a basic mail service, they don't let you do a POP or an IMAP.
You have to
do a Yahoo Plus.
That's right.
Incoming messages. So I assume we're going to have to do that for a little while. But is there something?
Well, I would pay for the pro version, and then you can pop it over to your Gmail account.
Okay. And do you think Gmail is a good?
Well, let me hold on a sec. We'll talk. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. I'm going to explain this all, but I would never trust a business to Yahoo or AOL Mail, and I think Google Mail's fine. In fact, I would get, as you said, Google Apps for Business. She should probably get a Google App domain. I use GPG tools, yes, Matthew, for my encryption. Encryption. So you can, without paying for Yahoo, forward it? You don't have to have a Yahoo Pro account to forward the mail? Yeah, if she's sending a lot of emails out, that's a problem. So we'll talk about that, too. I don't know Web 3327, but I expect Apple to do an event in October. Actually, I'd be shocked if they didn't, because they've at least got to announce the Mac Pro. We know they're doing that. They've already said it. I suspect they'll announce, although they don't have to, new iPads and new MacBook Pros. But they, you know, there's nothing that says they have to. Apple gets to do whatever it wants. Okay, so she doesn't have to pay for Yahoo Mail to forward it to her Gmail. Yeah, she should use MailChimp or something like that. Yeah, the with location is very cool. But that may be more than she needs. We'll have to find out what she's doing. She may be sending three emails out. We don't know. Huertas, I've done all the calls for the Tech Guy episodes, but I have to record 18 segment ones, which are those little sermonettes I do. So I don't think I'll do those live on the air. I think I'll be doing those in private on tomorrow. Next new Twitch show, well, we have several in the works. I'm not sure which will be first. But we're not going to do anything while we're gone, obviously.
Oh, my God. Home stretch?
So tired.
Oh.
For you, not for me. I got a long miles to go before I sleep.
Shoot. Shut up, Heather.
Cornstarch, I know you're really fixated on this Thurrott story. Yes, he got pickpocketed. That's not the story I was telling. It was the Dvorak story. And it's very different. It's similar but different to Thurrott's story. I've heard them both. You just never heard it, so you're assuming it's Thurrott, but it's not. It's exactly the story I told about the girl with the baby and a gypsy woman who placed something down on her stuff and took it. I think it was just his phone, actually. I don't know if it was his wallet, too.
Kim was going to almost come up today.
Kim
Wonderly.
Oh, I love Kim Wonderly.
She got a wild hair because her husband was playing golf in the area, blah, blah, blah.
She should have. She'd have been bored sitting around.
Well, we keep talking about how we're going to have so much fun in Petaluma, and I'm like, well,
if you guys go to Lagunitas, you will have fun.
I said, you're going to have to make it, you know, late October, November, because he's hitting
around. Oh, with me?
What?
With me?
We're going to party with you, Leo.
Oh, wow.
Well, she's going to come first here and party, and then we'll go party.
Oh, that would be fun. I wouldn't mind doing that. That would be great.
By party, I mean shop.
Yeah.
And eat burritos or something like that. But whatever you want. Kind of looking forward to fall. Because now I'm thinking about when you'll get back and what the weather will be like.
It's going to be fun.
The whole world.
And you got to come to, you and Kim have to come to our New Year's party.
I know.
That's going to be really fun. Okay. So we were talking to Kathy, and you know, it's worth spending a little time on this because I think a lot of people are, especially if you have a business, probably not doing the best they can with their email. So, Kathy, I do, it doesn't matter. You can use Yahoo Mail, you can use Gmail, you can use Microsoft's Live Mail, you can use, I use a third-party well-known provider that does all the work for me. Somebody's going to have to host the mail for you. You'd like somebody who hosts it using a technique called IMAP instead of POP. Those are two common mail protocols. And furthermore, you'd like somebody who will allow you to use your own domain name, kathysgreatwebsite.com, so that your email can be support at kathysgreatwebsite.com, calendar at kathysgreatwebsite.com, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Gmail will do this. In fact, a really good way for a small business to do this is Google Apps for Business. I think it's $6 a year per person. What they'll do is they'll hook up your domain name to Google Mail, but you'll also get Google Calendar. You get all these great corporate things. So our mail, for instance, mail.twit.tv is Gmail. It's our corporate mail. A lot of companies do this. A lot of schools are doing it. Universities. My son just started at the University of Colorado at Boulder, and that's what they use for their mail. It's just simpler to let Google do the back end. And then you can, you know, worry about your business. Now, you said you sent out some mailings as well. Do you do a lot of mailing?
Well, they're intermittent batches.
And how big are the batches?
Well, we usually send out a notice to all of our clients, about 3,000 of
them. Oh, okay.
But we send them out in batches of the maximum of 500 a day.
Yeah, so let's get rid of that. This is not how to do that at all. That's really, because most mail providers will say you're spamming.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're going to want to sign up for something like MailChimp.com, which is it's designed to do internet emails. They do some nice things. It sounds like it would be useful. For instance, they can sort your contact list by location. So you can say email everybody in Southern California or email everybody in Hawaii because we're going to be there. Email everybody in Covina. That's very handy. So MailChimp.com.
And that sounds exactly like what we need.
Yeah, it sounded like that's your business. So, yeah. And the other reason you want to do that is so that you don't get branded as a spammer.
Yeah, that's the thing that we have found. We get a lot of bounce backs when we send the emails out. And we're concerned about changing our email address because so many of our clients recognize it in their spam as an unblocked. So there's that transition that we're worried about.
Exactly. And it's going to be a little painful, but I think the transition will make it better in the long run. You're going to have to fix this problem.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So let's do it. Let's do it now. You can keep the Yahoo account, and I would. You can have Yahoo. It turns out you don't have to pay for the feature of Yahoo Mail forwarding your mail to another address.
Oh.
So that you just set up in your Yahoo settings. Whenever a message comes to our old address, forward it, just like the post office, forward it to the new address.
Okay.
And so you don't have to ever get rid of your old address. Check, log in once in a while, because Yahoo has this nasty habit, I think it's very bad, of reclaiming unused email addresses. That's a terrible thing, Yahoo. You shouldn't be doing that.
Yeah.
So you just log in every few months and you'll be fine on that one.
And you said that you used a third-party email service to deal with your clientele. Is that something that we should be considering? We looked into them. We just couldn't find one that seemed appropriate and streamlined but still doing what we need.
I've used fastmail.fm for a long time. They're an Australian. Actually, they got bought by Opera, so they're owned by the Norwegian company Opera. I use Fastmail for a variety of reasons. It's very modern IMAP. It's pretty sophisticated. So there's a lot of tools you can use on there. But there are many companies. Island Mail is another one. There are many companies that provide paid mailing services. But remember, Gmail is free or very inexpensive. And, you know, Gmail has the best spam fighting ever. So,
yeah.
You know, for you, that's great. Now, Gmail will not let you send thousands of emails at a time. They as most people won't.
Right. And so for that, we'd have to use something like MailChimp on those occasions that we wanted to send out.
It's by far the better way. They have, for instance, double opt-in so that you don't accidentally spam somebody.
Okay.
You know, there are services. People do this to me all the time. They sign, because my email address is well-known, they sign me up for dating services, all sorts of stuff I don't want. And these, what's annoying is places like Match.com doesn't check. They don't. What they should do is what's called double opt-in. So if somebody goes and signs Leo up at mail that Match.com, then Match.com sends an email to that address saying, "Did you sign up?" And if I don't respond to it, they don't send me anything more. They don't. But Match.com wants everybody they can get, so they don't care. So don't do that. That is spam. But MailChimp will handle this for you. MailChimp has the double opt-in. It'll make sure you really wanted to do this. Yeah, you really wanted mail from Kathy. Yes, I did. What do you do? Are you personal shoppers, tailors?
Actually, we are non-anesthetic veterinary dental hygienists.
Love that. So you go around in a little truck and you clean dogs' teeth.
We do. We go, and we're based in California, but our clients are all over the country. And
perfect.
When we're going to do a big gig in next month, and we need to send out a notice to them with our schedule, and we tried to do it with Yahoo, and Yahoo made everybody a New Yorker.
Yeah, precisely. MailChimp.com.
Okay.
Okay. MailChimp.com. It will save your life. And then I think it's fine to use Gmail. If you really get serious about it, you can use, Google Apps for Business, but you don't need to. You can use the free one for the time being and have your Yahoo Mail forward over there. But most importantly, whoever is your domain registrar for your website, you want to go over to their website and figure out how you can get email forwarding. Because you want from now on to have people email your website and then have it forwarded to Gmail or whatever you end up using.
I see. And that's something that we can do on our own, or do we have to have our web person do that for us?
It depends on the hosting company. If you know who is, if you know where the domain name is registered, you can probably do it yourself. But if you've got a web person, I would have, you could also ask the web person to do that.
Okay. We'll ask our web girl.
Yeah. She'll know all about this. Say, we want email redirection from our website.
Email redirection. All right.
Everybody should, in fact, even individuals should do this. Because you're not going to be Yahoo for the rest of your life. Maybe you're going to try something else.
We don't want to be Yahoo. Not ever again.
You want to have everybody send email to Kathy at Kathy's cleanteeth.com. What is the domain name?
It is houndstoothpetdental.com.
Love it. So you want them to email Kathy at houndstoothpetdental.com. That's what you want. And that way, your address will never change.
Yeah.
No matter who you use as an email provider, they should always be mailing it to your website. And then they'll remember your website. It's a virtuous circle.
That sounds perfect. That's exactly what we were hoping for.
Thanks, Kathy.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Take care. You don't do people, do you? Because I can, my cusp it here is just a little. Actually, I could use this for Ozzy. He could use a little gal to pull up in a truck and clean his teeth. I'm not doing it. You're supposed to brush your dog's teeth every day? I'm not doing that.
Dog's teeth.
Do you brush your dog's teeth?
I don't have a dog, but I would if
smart,
I did, because I hate
woman.
The way dog's breath smells.
Well, their
smells.
Breath smells, and that's kind of a sign, isn't it? Dave in Huntington Beach, California. Oh, wait a minute, Dave. Hold on. I knew as soon as I said your name that Nathan would play this music, and that tells me I have to leave so that we can hear from our fine sponsors, but I shall return, and you'll be next. Leah Laporte, the tech guy, last segment of the show before I head out on vacation. And reminder, we will have all new material for you for the next 3 weeks. Don't worry, we've gotten it. Everybody's chimed in, pitched in. We did it in secret. In a secret lair, we recorded a total of 6 shows, unheard of, never heard before shows. So you'll have all new material in the next 3 weeks, and I'll be back, and you'll be sad. Let me see. We started with Dave, and I didn't get to finish it because the music came on. Dave, Leo Laporte, the tech guy, thank you.
Yeah, hi, Leo, a first-time caller. Been listening to you since the tech days on TV, and sorry, it's CES
you.
Show. I'm 1995.
Holy cow, you go way back with me.
Well, I go back even further. I've been wiring homes for 42 years, high voltage, but what I do is I lock in a low voltage contract, meaning average home along the coast here, Huntington Beach, Newport Beach, Seal Beach, et cetera. And they're about 2,800 square foot homes, new homes. And all of a sudden, the builders bailed out here. 3 or 4 years ago, and now they're coming back, and so am I. But some of the builders are saying, oh, you don't need all these wires for all these things. I do everything Wi-Fi. But what we were doing before, Leo, is running to your TVs and phones. We were running RG6 dual shield and Cat5e.
Yeah.
Although some of the stuff's Cat6. And
well, see, that's the problem, isn't it? It's hard to.
Now, how would you wire?
Yeah, it's hard to future-proof it, isn't it? Because Cat5e was great at the time, but now. Well, everybody's using Wi-Fi. I was the guy. If you've been listening that long, you probably heard me say, if you've got the walls open, put in Cat 6. But I don't know if that's still a good recommendation. The Wi-Fi explosion took me all off guard.
I know.
So we use Cat 6. You need Cat 6 for gigabit Ethernet, and that is one of the standards. There's going to be even faster than that. But we put Cat 6 in our studio, for instance, trying to future-proof it. 5E is good enough for some implementations, but hey, if you're putting it in, it's not much more expensive to put 6. On the other hand, what about fiber?
Well, I ran, you know, the very first job I ever did was about, I don't know, when I saw you in 95 at the CES show, was the guy said, if you want to do a low voltage, you got to do fiber. So I hooked fiber up in his house.
But nobody's using it yet.
He's never used it.
No, fiber switches are so expensive that it's not practical. That's the problem with future proofing. I have to say, I think wireless turns out to be a pretty strong technology. There's no infrastructure involved. If you put in 5E or Cat 6, certainly I would be thrilled to have a new home that had Ethernet wired through the walls. It would sure save me having to worry about Wi-Fi interference and all that stuff. And, hey, wired is faster. Wired is faster.
Yeah, because I run in our home. We have Wi-Fi, but in part of the house, we can't get to Wi-Fi very well.
Right. And so, if you got the walls open, how much more expensive is it to put a few hundred feet of a Cat 5 cable in there?
Well, that's what we tell all the people because they say, "Well, I'll just go wireless and everything." I said, "Yeah, but we've had problems, but especially with Wi-Fi." So, make a long story short, almost everything we do is new, and so when we get the wires in, it's cheap, like you say. And,
it's a $500
TV, for example. Yeah. Say an average bedroom, you or your tech department. How would they say you were to wire a house?
Well, this building is wired. When we came in, we wired it, and it was originally wired with Cat 5, and that wasn't fast enough for us. Did we put 5E or 6 in, Burke? What did we end up putting in here? Five.
Six is
expensive. Yeah, and it's hard. We do our own crimping.
Cat 5E
will go to gigabit Ethernet, and that's what we're using is gigabit everywhere. I think, you know, there's 10 gigabit standards coming. I mean, the standards are out there, so there's no such thing as future proofing with hardware. It's always going to be outmoded, but you can, as you experienced, you can go too far too. By putting in fiber.
You know, like these spec houses, they haven't even sold yet. A lot of them are spec houses. How would you?
I'd put 5E in.
How about a TV, for example?
Well, I certainly would expect, if I moved into a new home, to have cable, you know, have coax cable into the every room. The other thing I think a lot of people don't do is put in a lot of plugs. You know, there's never enough plug sockets. Yeah. And put them high, put them low, put them all over the place. So I guess I would put in, I'd put in a conduit that would make it easy to pull for future, right?
HDMI or whatever.
Yeah. I wouldn't put in HDMI. I'd put it in coax. The house I'm in right now, the guy did something kind of cool. He put in a coax, but then he also dropped a string. He put an HDMI outlet up top and dropped a string so I could pull an HDMI cable if I wanted to, or pull coax up if I wanted to. That's kind of a nice. I don't think there's any way to future-proof it. 5E, I would say, is good enough. Coax and 5E is good enough. Do it in a conduit so they can pull more if they want to. You know, a big enough conduit. And I think you're probably fine. I mean, who knows?
How many coax? Some kind of guys say you only need one coax, and other people say you need three coaxes, for a home theater. I don't know anymore.
Well, here's one thing, and it depends how sophisticated your buyers are, but Burke's pointing out, one of our engineers, that for instance, and I use this situation, if you want HDMI to go 80 feet, you don't use an HDMI cable. You use what's called balans. You'll use something that'll convert the HDMI to Ethernet. So if you've got that Cat 5E in there, you're golden. You put the Ethernet in there, and then they have. So, in other words, 5E is flexible enough you could do a lot more stuff with it.
Balans. Okay.
Yeah, balans, yeah. They're not cheap.
How many coaxes would Bert run from the equipment down low up?
Well, you want one. You want to be able to get one cable system in there. I don't think you have to require people putting more than one cable system in there.
Really?
No, come on.
Well, I don't know.
But I would put a cable drop in every place that you might want a TV, which nowadays is everywhere, every room.
Just one coax, huh?
Yeah, I think so. I don't know. Do people get two cable boxes? I don't know. I don't think so. I think you have one cable account. You might have. That's a good question. I'm not the expert on this one. That's a very good question. I don't know.
Yeah.
But you know what? Go to our website, techguylabs.com, because we're going to put this there, and I bet you people will go there and weigh in. And there's probably. And I see the chat room's going crazy with.
Good.
Yeah, they have lots of ideas. People want, all sorts of
stuff.
I think two Cat 5Es to each location is going to do the job because of balans. That's what I say. And I think a single cable, but anybody else wants to weigh in, go to techguylabs.com and add it to the comment box. This will be a hot thread. Chris, in Miami, Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hi, Chris.
Leo, how you doing?
I'm great.
I wanted to ask you real quick. I know I don't got much time, but I wanted to ask you, iOS 7 is supposed to be coming out this week. I'm interested more so in the new iTunes radio. Is that
yeah.
Yeah.
That's great.
Is it a part of it, or is it?
It is.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
So I would be slow to jump on iOS 7. This is my counsel to everybody because, well, it will come out on the 18th. Not all apps are working with it. Most are, though, because it's been a long beta. People have had a chance. More importantly, it's cosmetically very different. And I think it may be an abrupt change for some people. You never want to be the first person to use a new operating system. As well tested as this is, I'd probably delay just for a little bit, see what people say about it. Hey, thanks for the call. Thanks for joining me. See you next time. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Well, that's it for the Tech Guy show for today. I'm Leo Laporte. Thank you so much for joining us. Don't forget, the Tech Guy is just the tip of the iceberg. We do nearly 30 shows now on the Twit Netcast Network, and you'll find them all at twit.tv. We talk about Windows and Windows Weekly, Macintosh and MacBreak Weekly, iPad and iPad Today. You get your daily dose of tech news from Tech News Today and our weekly roundtable show, This Week in Tech. It's all at twit.tv. And I'll be back next time with another great Tech Guy podcast. Thanks for joining me. See you next time.